Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for the Tech Guy is provided by CacheFly. CacheFly.com. Hi, this is Leo Laporte, and this is my Tech Guy podcast. This show originally aired on the Premier Radio Networks on Saturday, June 1st, 2013. This is episode 983. Enjoy. The Tech Guy podcast is brought to you by Ring Central. We do everything in the cloud. That's why I love my cloud-based phone system from Ring Central. Zero startup costs, and Ring Central is just $20 per month per user. Try it now with a 30-day risk-free trial, and when you buy one desk phone, you'll get a second phone free up to 20 phones. Call 800-543-9980 or visit ringcentral.com and use our promo code TWIT. And by Gazelle. The fast and simple way to sell your used gadgets. Find out what your used Samsung Galaxy, iPhone, or other smartphone is worth at gazelle.com. Hey, 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 how are you today? Leo Laporte here, the Tech Guy. And it's time to talk about computers, the internet, cell phones, camcorders, MP3 players, home theater, all that jazz. Phone number is 888-ASK-LEO, 888-827-5536, toll free from anywhere in the U.S. Outside the U.S., you can use Skype and call us. Heather H. will be answering your call. She's awaiting your call right now. Anxious to hear from you. 888-827-5536. And we could talk about certainly anything having to do with tech. Our home theater guru, Scott Wilkinson, joins us at 33 and a third after the hour, so we could talk about home theater then, but now too. You know, I like talking about it. Digital photography's one of my favorites. Today's Haswell Day, among other things. That's Intel said there really isn't much of a reveal or a surprise, but Intel said June 1st we will be making the next generation i7, i5, i3 available. The next Intel chip. And you know what they do is they have what they call a TikTok development cycle. So I think are we on the tick or the talk? So one of them, I think the tick is a big upgrade in power, in capability. And then the other one is making it smaller and better, you know, cheaper and faster. So tick, I guess, is the shrinking. Tick is a shrinking, and talk is the new microarchitecture. So now the next question is, we didn't shrink, so we must be talking. Can we talk? This is a 22 nanometer, which is awfully small. 22 billionths of a meter process called Haswell. It will actually be shrunk. It's scheduled to be shrunk. They aim the shrink ray at it next year, and that'll get down to kind of a stunning 14 nanometers, 14 billionths of a meter. So Sandy Bridge jumped down to 22. Haswell, the new one, stays at 22, but jumps down to 14. So I guess this is a talk. And the biggest deal about this, about Haswell, there's two. One is it will get you better battery life, and everybody wants that on their mobile devices. By the way, Intel chips not used in tablets. Well, I guess in Windows tablets, but not used in iPads and Android tablets, not used on smartphones at all, much to Intel's chagrin. But in this case, they're going to improve battery life on laptops considerably, on Windows tablets considerably, plus improve the graphics performance. So this is much welcome. In fact, a lot of us have been waiting for new laptops till the talk. We'd like to get the talk. So that's very confusing. Yes, Mark in Boston's reminding me, and this is another confusing thing that Microsoft did to us. When I say Windows tablets, I mean Windows Pro tablets, not Windows RT tablets. Microsoft created two completely incompatible different versions of Windows. Thank you very much. So, yes. So, it has well. We've been waiting. Now, one of the reasons I'm interested is because I think Apple will announce new laptops in 10 days at its Worldwide Developers Conference using the new processor. The new ticked or talked? I can't remember. It's a talk, then it's a tick. We're currently on the talk, but we will tick later. So the new talk processors, the Haswell processors, which are, again, about 50%, they're saying, better battery life. That's actually quite a bit if you've got a laptop like the one in front of me. That's a Dell XPS 13 laptop Ultrabook that's running the last version of the Intel processor, the Sandy Bridge processors. That's going to be... Actually, this might be Ivy Bridge. In any event, it could be more confusing, isn't it? This will, which gets about 4 hours of battery life, suddenly get six if you put a new chip in it, which you can't. But if you buy a new one, you'll get better battery life. You'll also get, you may get some speed improvements. I think they're kind of minor, but you'll get some significant improvements in graphics performance. And that's something Intel really needed to do because, the built-in graphics capabilities on a lot of these, it's kind of weak, not great for gaming, enough for simple browsing and so forth. But as we get to higher resolution screens, this XPS 13, it's a 13-inch screen at 1920 by 1080. It's a very high-res screen. You need a lot of graphics power just to display stuff, because you're pushing a lot of pixels. So this is very much welcome. They say this will be compatible or as powerful as some of the dedicated chips from NVIDIA. So good news. So that's happening today. That means the chips are shipping today, and you'll start seeing new Haswell-based, and that's probably what you should look for, Haswell-based processors, laptops. Interestingly, we were pretty sure that Apple would do new laptops in 10 days because the supplies of the MacBook started to dry up. Now the supplies of the Mac Pro are starting to dry up. That's good news. Maybe we'll see a new Mac Pro, a new desktop as well. That'd be pretty cool. Let's see, what else is going on? In the world of hardware, I think there's a sad story. I almost hate to bring it up, but I have this thing in front of me called an Oculus Rift, which is a Kickstarter project. They raised lots of money on Kickstarter a while ago, and they just started shipping these. They're virtual reality glasses. You put it on your head, you look kind of silly, but you're able to look around inside an environment, and it senses your movement of your head, and as you move your head to look around inside the environment, you actually are looking around. It's quite an amazing technology. Sad story, though. The guy who created Oculus VR, he's just a 33-year-old entrepreneur, got killed in Irvine. Actually, he was in Santa Ana, California, yesterday by a hit and run during a gang incident. The police were chasing a gang member. The speeding car struck Andrew Scott Rice as he was crossing the street. Very sad story and a great loss. When you have somebody that young who's really making a difference, really changing the world. People were so excited about the Oculus Rift. They raised more than $1 million on Kickstarter last year. And it started coming out in the last few months. And I just got mine last week. So it's a very, very sad story. I mean, these things happen, I guess. But you have to wonder, man, what this guy might have done over the next few decades, and we'll never know, will we? Let's see, what else is going on in the world of technology? We're thinking there's going to be a new. Speaking of Microsoft Windows 8, we're going to get the first look at Windows 8.1 in a couple of weeks at Microsoft's Build conference end of June. And we're already starting to see some of the screenshots and stuff leak out. Boy, it's kind of a big upgrade. It will be free. So if you bought Windows 8 and you're a little confused by it, as many of us are, maybe a little feeling like, gosh, I wish I could go back to Windows 7, you might wait. Not sure exactly when the final release will be out. I think sometime in September. But everybody who's seeing Windows 8.1 was codenamed Blue is saying this is a big kind of acknowledgement by Microsoft that Windows 8 isn't exactly what people had hoped for. My friend Paul Thurrott, who writes a Windows blog, said Microsoft's taking a mulligan. Wow. I don't know what's going on. I opened my Windows 8 laptop to talk about it, and it seems to be having a good time. Okay, let's stop that. Isn't that weird? The laptop's been sleeping for 4 days, and it's been, I don't know, it's, I guess it was, you know, didn't think I was around. It was playing a game while I wasn't there. Actually, that was a very cool thing. We'll talk about that. It's a Google game called Roll It. That's pretty cool. Hey, lots to talk about. Let's tell you what. Let's go to the phones. 8888 Ask Leo. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Yeah, that was Roll It. I guess it was still running. Oh, my goodness. Our show today brought to you by my buddies, my good friends at ringcentral.com. Got to talk a little bit about RingCentral right now. RingCentral is the cloud-based phone system we use here at the Brick House. And we use it because Russell saved my life when we built this almost 2 years ago now. Actually, I made this decision more than 2 years ago. In January 2011, when we leased this place, I knew I was going to suddenly be in a large facility and have, you know, maybe as many as 15 employees. We now have 25. And I knew that I needed to have a phone system. And I was really nervous about going to AT&T and getting the PBX and all that stuff. And that's when Russell, our contract, he's not an employee, he's a contract IT guy, said, I have many clients. I've installed RingCentral for them, and they're very happy. And we did it. And man, are we happy. RingCentral is low as $20 per month per employee, and that includes long distance. It includes the RingCentral, the free RingCentral app for your phone that gets your, that you can place calls on the business line from your smartphone. You can receive calls to the business line on your smartphone. You can even get texts. I tell you, RingCentral is amazing. And now, if you use Salesforce, you're going to be thrilled. The RingCentral app for Salesforce.com integrates your phone calls with your CRM seamlessly. So as you're on the phone call, you can create records for contacts and leads, real-time call notes while you're on the call. But all of this, you know, SMS, conferencing, Salesforce integration is possible because it's cloud-based. It's all software. This is the right way to put a business line in your office. RingCentral.com. Right now, we've got a 30-day risk-free trial. A special offer for my listeners. When you buy one desk phone, you'll get a second phone free, up to a total of 20 phones. That's a good deal. Call them, 800-543-9980, 800-543-9980, or visit ringcentral.com. Use the promo code TWIT. Ringcentral.com. Use the promo code TWIT. You're going to love it. You know this, do you know this song?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody now.
Call me!
I saw Blondie's drummer, Clem Burke, is in a different band. Saw them Thursday night.
See, you can't fool H-Bomb. She knows all.
Hanging out with rock stars.
She's like the music queen. Yeah, it's Blondie. Call me. So call me. 8888-ASK-LEO. 888-827-5536. I'm having to slap me around. I'm having trouble getting started. I'm going to finish this cup of coffee. Maybe sometimes you ever have that, like, you know, I felt fine. I got up at 6 in the morning. I've been up for hours, but I just...
You got up too early.
Maybe I got up too early. Just kick me in the head. Who
Somebody
should we...
just didn't sleep correctly.
Maybe if I ate this Vegemite that some... we had an Australian viewer stop by, and he brought me some Vegemite. Maybe if I ate that. Do you know Kraft makes Vegemite? It's a Kraft product?
They bought it.
Proudly made in Australia since 1923, but Kraft bought it recently. What's so good about Vegemite? I don't know.
That is the worst. I dare you to even smell it.
I like it. It's yeast.
Are you kidding?
No, I actually like it. I like it. A little toast. So who should I talk to first?
Let's see.
That woke me up. That was good. I feel I'm awake. I'm awake.
Did
Thank
it work?
You. Yeah.
Oh, good.
Hello.
It's kind of like horseradish.
Hello.
Or something. Well, I like Marie in Temecula because it's one of those. Oh, the extended warranty went out, and then.
Oh, you know, I'm having a trouble with AT&T and an extended warranty. So we will talk. Marie, Temecula, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Thank you, Heather. Hi, Marie.
Hey. Good morning, Leo. Thanks for taking my call.
Thanks for calling. What's going on?
We bought a 50-inch Vizio TV, and we bought the extended warranty. The warranty expired at the end of last year, and the TV went out about a month ago. It just popped, and then we had a black flashing screen. So I went online, and I saw some of the threads. People said that Vizio was aware of the problem, and they were making good on it, even if the warranty was expired.
Wow, that's nice of them.
Well, but there was other threads that said that they called and couldn't get any service from Vizio. Plus, there was some advice on how to repair the problem.
No. What do you have to do to repair the problem?
I don't know, replacing circuit boards or...
Yeah, no, I don't I wouldn't think there's any user serviceable parts in there. If you're a repair person, perhaps. Okay. I'm not sure what the pop is. Could be the power supply failing. Could be a capacitor on the motherboard. You know, these things are just computers with big screens.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how old is it? You said you got an extended warranty, so it's got to be more than a few years old now.
We bought it in 09. We bought it in 09, and we purchased the 3-year extended warranty. And it went, I think it expired like in November.
Yeah, I mean, the extended warranty doesn't really mean anything one way or the other. Vizio, in fact, does not have any obligation to fix this. But if it's something that's been failing on all of them, then they might have a interest in fixing it. Is it an LCD?
I'm not quite sure. Okay. I think it's an LED.
Yeah, that's LCD, too. That's just the name of the backlight. Yeah, so you spent a lot of money on this, and I understand your distress, but I don't know. They probably are, you know, so can you go back to the dealer you got it from? Who'd you get it from?
We bought it at Sam's Club, and we haven't tried to go back to them. I just figured the warranty was expired. Sam's Club isn't responsible for it. I was just wondering if you had any.
No, you know, I'll be honest with you, Marie. Nobody's responsible for it. Nobody has an obligation to fix it for you. However, both Sam's Club and Vizio might have an interest in having a happy customer, so both of them might be willing to respond. So I'd start with Sam's Club because that's where you got it.
Okay.
And they may say, oh yeah, we know about this. Vizio's contacted us. They're not going to contact end users. But maybe they know about it. They'll go through the retailer.
Okay.
But, something fails after 4 years. They don't really have an obligation. I mean, it seems like a short lifetime, but they don't really have an obligation.
Yeah. If we're looking to replace it, what are your recommendations on a different TV?
Actually, Vizios are fine. I mean, they may have had a bad batch, which would the only excuse for them doing a global fix would be, oh, golly, we've got 4,000 customers with the same failure. Mm-hmm. Then they might do it. But they're a good company, and I think you could measure the response of Sam's Club and Vizio and use that as an indicator about whether to go back to Sam's Club or whether to go back to Vizio. That's why they have an interest in maybe fixing it, even though I have no legal obligation. I'm a big fan. I like the Panasonic plasmas. They're getting out of that business, I'm afraid. At least that's the rumor.
Are.
Yeah, that's the rumor. Samsung's the only one that's really doing okay in the business. We found out the other day that Sony loses money on its electronics business. The only thing that's keeping Sony afloat is they sell insurance in Japan. They're a big insurance company in Japan. Oh. The Japanese TV manufacturers are all taking a bath.
Wow.
Yeah, isn't it? It's hard to believe, but they're all taking a bath. Now, Vizio is kind of an interesting mix. They're made in China, but the company is in Southern California. So that's why you might have a shot at it.
Okay.
One thing always to do is to write a letter, a physical letter, to the CEO. You might follow it up with an email, but that isn't that's always a good idea. You know, again, they don't have an obligation. One thing you can do. I'm looking at the Vizio site, and they do have a tracking information on there. You might enter in if they've done a recall or they've done a mass fix, you might want to check with the Vizio site and see if there's something about that. I certainly wouldn't want to throw it out until you've at least checked.
Yeah, well, that's what we're thinking. We were looking to replace it with the Vizio Smart TV.
Yeah, they're good. They're nice. I've played with them. Yeah.
Yeah, so that might be our next possibility.
Yeah, it's not a bad company. These things happen, frankly. Stuff fails, and You know, that's, I don't generally recommend extended warranties because if electronics are going to fail, they're going to fail either right away or not for a long time. And you kind of, okay, you kind of got unfortunate. You got in the middle there. I'm betting it's a capacitor on the circuit board that that just was probably had a manufacturing defect. It may not be too hard to fix, but well, you got to find somebody who can fix it. It's not you.
Yeah. Okay. I will definitely follow up with.
Start with Sam's Club. You know, Sam's Club's pretty good. Go to the website on Vizio, but Sam's Club's good about that kind of thing. And okay, and the chat rooms, Celtics Pride in the chat room saying the squeaky wheel gets the grease. That's true, but it, you know, it's also a measure of how much time you've got to be squeaky.
Do you,
you got a life too.
If it's going to save me a lot of money, it's well worth, you know, squeaking.
Yeah, although I, you know, 50 inches nowadays, we're talking $800.
Exactly.
They got a lot cheaper.
Well, Samsung had the 50-inch smart TV for like $649.
There you go. So if it's 20 hours of your time versus $649, it is a shame. I mean, I'm completely sympathetic because when something fails that fast, it shouldn't fail that fast. It should last. You know, it's funny. We're also in this kind of a changing mode. We were used to TVs going for decades, right? When you bought that Sony Trinitron, you didn't expect to buy another one until 1999. All of a sudden, they're failing in a few years. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. I didn't even done any ads today. Let's do a gazelle. What do you say? G-A-Z-E-L-L-E. Somebody, I got two emails yesterday. The drumbeat is happening from people saying, hey, where can I get rid of my, where is that place you recommend to sell your old stuff? I think people are getting ready for new iPhones, new iPads, new hardware. And it's a good time to go to Gazelle right now because what happens with Gazelle is you get a 30-day quote and you don't have to sell it. It's not a commitment to selling it. You're just going to get the quote that's good for 30 days. So it'll be good through the rest of June. If any big company should make any big announcements, now you got the price locked in. You see what I'm saying? Cash for all sorts of devices, tablets, lots of different manufacturers, Apple, Amazon, Asus, Google, Microsoft, and Samsung. Of course, any generation of iPad, including the mini and the first generation. Cell phones from BlackBerry, HTC, LG, Motorola, Nokia. Let's say you have Samsung Galaxy S3, which actually I do have. And you looked at your Galaxy S3 and you're saying, oh, you know, I just found my Note. It's in good condition. Actually, it's probably in flawless. But you can downgrade the condition a little bit. They will upgrade it if they get it and they say, hey, you know, this is a better condition than you said. $200 right there. That's your HTC One. Talk about a great upgrade. You got an old iPhone? You want to trade that in? Just go right there and enter in the data and get an offer. $210. Bada bing, bada boom. Now, here's the beauty part. Anything worth more than a buck, Gazelle will send you a box and a mailing label. Take care of all the mailing. You ship it back to them. They'll wipe the data for you. And, yes, they'll upgrade your offer if it's better condition than you said. Then they'll send you a check or a PayPal credit. Or, and this is my pro tip, if you use Amazon a lot, get the Amazon gift card because they bump that value 5%. So, you know, you got $1,000 in there. That's $50 extra. That's not bad. G-A-Z-E-L-L-E. They even buy old Macs, MacBooks, iPods. It's a good time. I'm upgrading to the new MacBook. Maybe that's why I'm getting all these requests. Because, you know, I want to get the new MacBook. I have a feeling Apple's going to announce one in 10 days. Get the lock in now. Gazelle.com. Good timing. Scott Wilkinson is here, our home theater expert. Scott is editor at avsforum.com and does a home theater podcast called Home Theater Geeks every Monday on our Twit network at twit.tv. So you heard Marie's call about the... I feel bad because, you know, 4 years is awfully fast for a TV to die.
It really is. And unfortunately, that is kind of the current reality. You were exactly right when you said... In years past, people bought TVs and expected them to last, and they did last 15, 20 years, easy. But nowadays, people are buying TVs every more like 5 years, yeah. I would think.
We're in the throwaway culture now.
We're in the throwaway culture, and also the technology is moving much faster than it did back then.
Well, and that's the good news for Marie is that new TV, which will cost her less, will look better, and you know she's going to get a smart
TV.
More. It'll do a lot more, has internet connection.
Yeah.
Although I just saw a stat I thought was kind of stunning that only, I think it was 11% of all TVs in the United States are smart. And only half the people who own smart TVs connect them to the internet. So it's a ridiculously low number. You know
that kind of reminds me. That kind of reminds me of the. I don't know the current stat, but it was for a long time true that a lot of people bought high def TVs and hooked them up to their standard def cable box or DVD player and thought, I'm getting high def now.
It's pretty common. It's pretty common. When there's new technology, it takes a while for people to take advantage.
Exactly.
So what about extended warranties? What do you think? Everybody asks me this.
Yeah, they ask me this too, and I totally agree with you. In general, I don't recommend them because, as you said, exactly right, electronics are going to either fail right away within the first year, which is when the manufacturer warranty is, or not for a long time. And the caller's TV just happened to fall in that crack. Between those two extremes.
Yeah.
Now the one extended warranty that I actually do tend to buy is on laptop computers.
Because they get banged up a bit, and
they get banged up, and when if you have to fix them, they're very expensive.
Right.
To fix.
Yeah, my attitude, you know, it's difficult because on the one hand, I don't want to be the guy who said, "Oh, don't buy that," and then 3 months later, you call me again and say, "Hey, I didn't buy it," and now who's going to fix it?
Right.
So there are plenty of anecdotal stories of somebody who's, you know, computer failed 23 times, but it didn't cost him anything because it was an extended warranty.
But
you've got to understand, it's anecdotal. You got to understand it is a profit center for the companies that sell them, whether it's the manufacturer or the store.
Or the third party warranty company.
That's right. Most stores don't do their own warranty repairs. They sell an insurance from another third party. Now, they make money on it. That's why they tell their salespeople to push it. And they do.
Right.
Boy, do they push
it.
It's hard not to get one.
In fact,
one.
It's a huge profit center.
So that tells you something. I mean, it's insurance.
Right.
So, but of course, you know, all insurance is kind of a profit deal. Look at those big buildings downtown built by insurance money. Look at Sony. Did you know that Sony survives on its insurance business alone?
No, I did not
know that. Isn't that sad come down for one of the great consumer electronics companies?
It really is. It really is. And you were also exactly right that the Japanese electronics companies, Sony, Panasonic, Sharp, are all suffering terribly
in
the electronics business.
Why is that?
I don't know. Because in particular, the Koreans, Samsung and LG, are not.
They're eating their lunch.
They're going fine. They're
doing the same
thing
in cell phones, too, you know? I mean, Samsung is rapidly becoming the number one cell phone company worldwide, just killing Nokia, BlackBerry. Even Apple is starting to, you know, being also ran. So, so you don't now. I'm going to put you on the spot. You don't recommend extended warranties, or you do?
I do not.
Okay.
Generally speaking, except for laptop computers, I don't buy them. And when people ask me, when my family asks me, should I get the extended warranty? I say no.
Yeah.
For
now,
exactly
what I say, and when I say it, is I decided to self-insure because I want you to understand that you're in effect doing your own insurance. In the long run, statistically, you'll come out ahead. But if you're one of those people who has the lemon laptop that goes in for repairs multiple times, you may hate me because then you are self-insuring and you're making an interesting decision. You know, even though you know. That it's like playing blackjack. The odds are in the house's favor always.
Yep, always.
But you know that because laptop repairs can be expensive, you kind of want to do that. You don't want to take the chance.
And to tell you the truth, I've actually been a beneficiary of it. I got an extended warranty on a previous laptop, and it broke. Something went wrong, and I was able to get it fixed for essentially free. I forget it. There was some deductible, but you know, generally speaking, it was a great thing. I was glad I had it.
Yeah. I have never had to worry about that. I've never bought an extended warranty, and I've never used one.
Yeah.
Although I've, and this is another thing, is sometimes people think, well, if you drop it, then they'll fix it. No. So I dropped my Surface RT, and you might say, well, Leo, aren't you glad you extended warranty on that? No, because they wouldn't have fixed it. I dropped it.
Right. That wasn't part of the warranty.
So
that's for defects in the thing. Now, if this TV had been under warranty, the Vizio of the
it
the
was. She had a 3-year extended warranty.
Right, and it dropped out at 4 years or right. whatever. But right. if it had been within the warranty, that was a defect, and they would have fixed it. Well, and as you say, if it's a problem that a lot of people are having,
they may fix
it's
it
in
anyway.
There. And yeah. Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
It's like cars too. You know, there's safety issues with cars that you don't have. I don't think anybody's been killed by a defective television.
No,
but
not unless they tried to go in and fix it themselves.
Well, and okay, that's the other thing. Don't try to fix it. She was really no. sounded like she was thinking maybe I'll go down to the TV parts store and buy the part that I need.
Well, I thought she said she read someplace that you could do that. And yeah. that is very bad advice.
Yeah. Don't well, it's worse advice on the old CRTs where you could actually kill yourself.
True, true.
I don't think that's because basically a CRT is a giant capacitor. It stores up a charge and you can accidentally discharge it into yourself and blow yourself across the room. But that right. is that the case with flat screens?
I don't think it is. I think you're right about that. There's not as much danger there as there was with
power
CRTs.
Supply might still be dangerous to you. I don't know.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what I'm thinking. And I was thinking when I heard her describe the problem that it might very well be a power supply.
It sure sounds like it, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah,
it does. Something pops and then the screen is black and does some weird flashing. That sounds kind of power-ish
like
power to me.
Power supply or bad capacitor on the motherboard.
Some capacitor like someplace. Yeah, exactly.
Another thing she might be able to do is buy a new TV and sell the old one on eBay. People do buy non-working TVs for parts, and some people, you know, are ambitious enough they think they're going to fix it.
Sure, you sure. know, or maybe they're learning, trying to learn right. how to fix right. TVs. Right. So, you know, you get a part like thing like that for parts. You know, you sell it for, you know, $50 or whatever, and that'd be okay.
Captain Video, aptly named, says the second anode on a color CRT, those old glass screen TVs, held 30,000 volts.
Yep, that's I recall something about tens of thousands of volts. Yes.
Oh,
yeah, you put that
man.
Through you, you're gonna feel it.
You wouldn't be happy. Yeah.
No, you would not be a happy camper.
There might be. It might not be if it's a circuit board and it's an easily replaceable circuit board and one that you can readily get. It might not be a tough fix, but I just makes me nervous.
Yeah, taking those TVs apart. I mean, you can do it. They have screws, and you take out the screws, but. Yeah, they're so tightly packed in there.
Right. It is of a vintage, 2009. There were bad capacitors going around, so it is of that vintage.
Really? Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, a lot of laptop manufacturers had similar problems with the capacitors. They leaked.
Okay.
They were poorly made. They were, Anyway.
Well, if it leaked, then you certainly don't want to try and repair it because it's got goop all over the place.
Don't eat the brown capacitor, man.
Exactly.
You'll be so sorry. Do you have a question and answer pair? Well, too late. We're out of time.
Yes, I don't.
So thank you so much, Scott.
My pleasure.
I used up all your time.
That's all right.
Scott Wilkinson, home theater guru, avsforum.com. But for those of you watching the podcast, here's the good news. Scott continues in living color on many of these same stations. Why don't you take it from here, Scott? I'll get out of your
police
way.
Police called and broke the bad news. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Always happy to chat with the chat room. Fortunately, we got to talk about something good and interesting and useful for people about TVs that break and warranties and stuff. But I had intended to talk about a great time I had yesterday listening to a new headphone format from DTS called DTS Headphone X, which simulates surround sound, 11.1 channel surround sound, in a standard pair of headphones. And its first application is going to be a free app for the iPhone and Android, which you can download for free. The only content that's mixed in 11.1 for Headphone X is the soundtrack, the score rather, from the new Man of Steel movie, the new Superman movie, music by Hans Zimmer. And I got to meet Hans Zimmer last night, yesterday morning, actually, well, afternoon. And we got to talk to him about the score, which is wonderful. I've actually seen the movie, but I can't talk about it till June 10th. So that is all there is I can say about that. But I can talk about Headphone X and Hans Zimmer, who is a wonderful composer. And the music for Superman or Man of Steel is really, really good. And he did a special 11.1 mix, which if you buy the deluxe edition of the soundtrack CD, you can download this app called Z Plus. Not sure why they called it that, but Z Plus. And then you can download the entire soundtrack, the entire score, rather, just the music, which has been mixed in 11.1.
But I need to have 12 speakers.
No, no. You just have to have any old pair of headphones.
Oh, the DTS does the...
Surrounding. Surrounding in the headphones. Wow. And it's remarkable. It's remarkable.
That's cool.
They gave
is
us a demo.
Is this their response to Atmos, kind of?
Actually, not really. It's more for the home. Atmos at this point is more for the theater.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay.
Or for the commercial theater. So, and maybe we'll see Atmos in a home package at some point, but I don't think for several years anyway. But plus Atmos is real speakers around the room. And DTS Headphone X is for headphones specifically. So you don't need to put a bunch of speakers in your room. And,
sorry, I'm just
and that's right. Yeah, checking. I understand. And have, you know, the spousal acceptance factor be a problem.
Oh, this is cool. But I need to get a DTS decoder somewhere. Huh?
No. All you need is the app in your smartphone. That's it.
It's a smartphone app?
It's a smartphone app.
Wow.
And at this point, it'll eventually be a decoder in AVRs and preamps and stuff. But for the moment, it's a free app, no less.
iPhone only?
No, Android as well.
Oh, downloading now.
Called Z Plus. Now, as I said, there's no the only content for it will be, and I'm not entirely sure it's available yet, but it will be very soon, is the musical score from Man of Steel. Which Hans Zimmer composed, and it was mixed specially in 11.1 for this app. And I have to tell you, it's really great. Hans wrote the score, and one of the central elements of the score is a drum circle. You've probably seen or heard drum circles. You know, people just gather and start banging on drums. Well, this was a drum circle of some of the best drummers in the world. And it's really amazing. And he mixed it so that it just... surrounds you below. It's really, really good.
Well, you know what? Let's talk about it on the air, because that's pretty cool. Hold on.
Sure.
Summer breeze makes me feel fine. June 1st. Not technically summer yet, but feeling pretty summery if you're on the East Coast. 100 degree temperatures yesterday in New York City. 100 degrees. Holy cow. I kept Scott Wilkinson around. And we'll get back to the phones in a second. I'm sorry, Heather. But Scott had an interesting experience last night. He wanted to share it with us. Now, he saw the movie Man of Steel, which we cannot say anything more about.
Afraid not. I'm under embargo till June 10th.
Just tug your... Oh, I can't do that to you. Tug his ear. You know, it's radio. It's safe. Tug your ear if you liked it. But Hans Zimmer did the music, the great Hans Zimmer. He's a wonderful composer.
Yep.
And they released it in a form that I'm very intrigued by. Tell me about that.
Yeah. He's working with DTS, which has a technology that we first heard at CES in January called Headphone X. And what Headphone X does is it takes a multi-channel surround sound mix up to 11.1 channels, which includes a 7.1 around you plus... height speakers, front and rear, plus a subwoofer. And it takes this 11.1 mix and puts it into any pair of headphones, regular, normal, stereo headphones. And we had a demo where we had the headphones off. They had 11.1 speakers around us. And they said, okay, listen to this. And so a voice said, right, front, left, front, center, you know, and we listened to the speakers.
Not
and they were
so
in the
hard.
Room.
You got 11 Not speakers. You just say, hey, make that one go that way.
Yeah, yeah. Then they said, put on the headphones.
No, because you only have two speakers, so that's not going to work.
But it did.
What?
It was amazing. It said, you know, we said right, front, left,
really?
Front, center. And I and the rest of the people who were under the demo took the headphones off to say, nah, that's the speakers have got to be on. They weren't.
So we've heard formats or ways to do this. Dolby had a Dolby headphone
Right, technology, which is also very nice.
Supposedly gave you surround, although I don't know if they ever released it in the U.S.
No, they did. It's in a couple of AVRs, not very many. A couple of audio-video receivers, but not...
Is this like that? Is this the same idea?
It is. It is the same
Except
idea.
Except that I suspect that the Dolby headphone didn't have 11.1 speakers.
No. It was, I think, limited to 5 or 7.
Yeah.
So this is much more of a three-dimensional sound feel.
And how does it do that? It's with computer technology. It's
total DSP.
So they use the computer to switch it around in your head.
Right.
Think about it. You're still using two ears when you're listening to 11 speakers.
Yep.
So it's not like that's. It's not like you've got more ears. So the
That's exactly right.
So the trick is, with two ears, you're able to directionally find these sounds. Yeah,
exactly. Because they use something called the head-related transfer function.
It's an HRTF. Thing. Okay.
Yes.
If you said that ahead of time, I would have...
You would understood.
Completely.
That's what they do. And what that does is it mimics what happens when a sound approaches you from a given direction. It has to bend around your head in different ways.
It's not like Doppler shifting and things like
that. No. But the ear is incredibly sensitive to differences in time down to the ten thousandths of a second in the arrival time of the sound between one ear and the next. And then there's this phase and filtering that happens when it comes from upper right or upper left or behind you or something. And so this algorithm takes care of all of that and creates a remarkable simulation of this 11.1 sound. And Hans Zimmer remixed the score for Man of Steel in 11.1. He had 11.1 speakers in his studio.
Now, here's the thing that really interests me. You can't buy a stereo system that does this. You can't buy headphones with this. It's an iPhone app. It's a free app.
A free app called Z, the letter Z, and then the plus sign.
Holy cow.
Yep. And you can get it free. And if you just get it, I'm not 100% sure it's actually available yet, but it will be very soon.
Wow.
And when you get it, you can get one track from the Man of Steel soundtrack. Just to try it. If you buy the deluxe version of the CD of the entire Man of Steel soundtrack, they'll give you a code and you can download the app and get the entire score in this DTS Headphone X.
Now, the chat room's saying that Zimmer did this for the Dark Knight Rises soundtrack as well. So you can actually... Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but it's...
I don't think he did Headphone X for it. I don't think he did an 11.1 mix.
It's a Z-plus app, but it's not Headphone X. Okay. We're looking for Headphone X is what we're...
Headphone X, yeah. Right.
Okay.
So it's...
Maybe it was some other kind of, you know, surround.
It might have been some other kind of thing. Yeah. I don't know. As far as I could tell from this press event we went to at Warner Brothers, we were on the studio lot of Warner Brothers yesterday. And listening to this in the soundstage where he had recorded the drum circle. One of the biggest elements of the score is this huge drum circle, and it's very effective. And he mixed it so that it's all around you. It's swirling all around you. It's very, very cool.
Oh, I'm intrigued.
I do recommend it.
So
you don't need new headphones.
And you said really? It's just regular everyday headphones?
Regular old headphones. We were listening to this on $100 Sennheisers.
Wow.
Just regular old headphones. You could do it earbuds, anything like that. I don't know that it's available just yet. I know it'll be very, very soon. They might have jumped the gun a bit, but
so the app may not be out yet. But keep looking for it.
But keep looking.
It's letter Z and plus.
And a plus symbol, yes, exactly. Okay. Z plus. Why they called it that for a technology called Headphone X, I'm not entirely sure. Z is the third dimensional axis. You know, when you talk about coordinates, you talk about X, Y, and Z.
Right.
And so I suspect that may be why they did that.
So it may or may not be out yet. The chat room says they can't find it, but that doesn't always mean it's not out because the app stores are weird. That sometimes it's out, but the search doesn't find
it.
But
they don't have it. Yeah, exactly.
Let me see if I can find a link somewhere on a website to it, and then we can...
Might be on DTS. Could go to DTS.com, and it might very well be
there. I'll do that. All right.
Also on Man of Steel.
Scott is the editor-in-chief at the AVS Forum, a great place to go for years, the place to go for information about video and so forth. It's a I'm so glad that you're working there now. He also does a podcast for us each week on Mondays, 2 p.m. Pacific, right?
Yep.
5 p.m. Eastern time. Twit.tv. Who's your guest day after tomorrow?
Day after tomorrow is Michael Fremmer. Right after this show, in fact, I'm heading down to Newport Beach where I'm going to an audiophile show. And Michael's going to be there. And on Monday on the podcast, we're going to do a wrap-up of what we heard at this audiophile show called THE, The Home Entertainment Show. Great. It's at the Hilton and Atrium Hotels right across the street from the John Wayne Orange County Airport. And if anybody's down there today, I'm going to be hanging out at the pool at the atrium at 6 p.m. So come say hi.
Very good. Very good. Thank you, Scott. Scott Wilkinson.
My pleasure.
Home theater geek extraordinaire. 8888 Ask Leo. That's the phone number. Let's get back to the phones here, in fact, and see who we can talk to. Lee is in West Hills, California, our next call. Hi, Lee.
Leo. Hello, Leo. Good to speak to you again.
Thank you.
I'm having difficulty with a Samsung Blu-ray player, but more with Samsung tech support, or what's called tech support. Blu-ray players, or specifically this one, and I have three of them, three identical ones, periodically Samsung issues firmware updates over the internet that's connected directly to the player.
Right.
The latest firmware update makes it so that you can't play Blu-ray discs that are longer than approximately an hour and 40, hour 50 minutes.
That's stupid.
When it hits that point, the playback speed slows down to something less than 100%, and the sound drops out. Now, you can get around it by stopping it, restarting the disc, searching to the scene, replaying again. But that's not really satisfying.
Have you heard anything about this, Scott? If this is a global problem, everybody with a Samsung Blu-ray player must be going crazy.
Screaming bloody murder. Yeah. I have not heard of this particular problem, but I have heard, unfortunately, other stories of Samsung tech support and customer support not being very good.
Yeah, I've heard the same.
So I'm sorry to say that that's the case. This is the first I've heard of this particular problem, and I will certainly look into it. I have contact.
I would guess, Lee, that they will fix this pretty pronto. I mean,
they'll release another software, another firmware.
Problem that.
Hold on. We got to take a break. Leo Laporte, the tech guy, will be back right after news from your local station. Stay here. As soon as we get out of here, we can continue on. So, I'm sorry, Lee, I didn't mean to cut you off there. So what's the issue?
Well, the issue is that tech support can only read their little list of things to do.
Right, yeah.
They have tech support, and the executive offices have no access, so they say, and probably true, to the people who generate the software. They can't even communicate the problem with them, and so they can't generate a new firmware because they can't even communicate with them that there's a problem.
I wonder if it is not a Samsung firmware update, but it is a key update. You know, one of the reasons that you have to keep your Blu-ray player hooked up all the time, and periodically you'll get a new Blu-ray disc and it will say, oh, I've got to go online and update the keys, is the paranoia of the movie industry. And it may be that this update is, in fact, not from Samsung.
Well, it directly followed the firmware update, which came out the day that Lincoln was released, which was 2 months ago. And
so the firmware update was for Lincoln?
Well, it could have been. It just says to associated with selective particular disc, but they never tell you which ones.
Yeah.
And you can't roll back. And
that's frustrating as hell.
That is frustrating.
Almost certain that they'll have a fix for that, but
But
how quickly?
But when? Yeah.
Specifically, it's the model D5300. It may only be that one, which is an old player, but it would work.
It's 2 years old.
And the firmware update, and unfortunately, I purchased. After I was satisfied with this, so I purchased two more that were refurbished, and I've confirmed that it drops out within 30 seconds or so at the same place, and it takes 2 hours to find out that it's that you have the same problem, because nobody can find the problem unless they put a disc in and sit back for 2 hours to wait for the sound to drop out.
Lee, to help us track this down, do you know off the top of your head the firmware version on those 5300s?
No. It's the one on the website, though.
It's the current one, the one that's now current?
Yes.
Okay, Samsung D5300, you said?
Yes.
Current firmware update. I'll certainly contact my contacts at Samsung and ask them what they know about it.
The interesting thing is that if you twist people's arms, they say, well, we'll send it back in for service. I say, well, wait a minute.
That's not the fix.
The best that's going to happen is you're going to give me another one
right.
with the prior firmware version. It's going to immediately ask to update the firmware and destroy itself again.
Right.
And so, like, what's that going to accomplish?
Right.
And nobody has the technical background to understand that, gee, that's a bad idea. And it's...
After how long does this problem manifest? 1 hour 40, you said, or so?
Somewhere between an hour 40 to an hour 55. It's if you have a disc that's an hour and 35 minutes, you play through fine, everything, no problem.
You said the audio drops out as well.
Yeah, well, I think what's happening first is the speed slows down, and because the speed is not 100%, the sound is gone. Because you don't get...
So actually the playback slows down? It looks like it's in slow-mo?
I wonder if this is DRM.
I don't know. I mean, the first is I did this update when Lincoln came out and had to watch the final 20, 30 minutes of Lincoln in subtitles. Since then, after playing about 15 more discs, I've found out that you could restart the thing. And then you could pick it up and not have to watch with subtitles.
But what about subtitles now?
Well, sound was bad he had to watch with subtitles.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, that was my first solution, which was put on subtitles. I wanted to see what was happening at the end of the movie.
Yeah, right.
And listening to Lincoln do his final speeches in subtitles didn't work.
And you say this now happens on every disc you play?
Every disc that's over, and it's not a...
That's over that period, yeah.
Yeah. And so, like, every time I get a rental from Netflix, I'm looking, it's 2 hours and 10 minutes. Okay, we're not going to make it through that one without having to restart. Oh, it's an hour and 35 minutes. Okay, I'm going to be able to watch that one without
any
problem.
That's really ridiculous.
It is ridiculous. Yeah. It's so ridiculous that I'm going to look into it. And, you know, if I find anything, perhaps I'll put something up on avsforum.com. So, you know, look there in a week or so and see if I found out anything.
Okay, or if we can just find a way to kick to the right people. It's shocking that the executive office doesn't have any access to firmware developers.
This is indeed shocking, but not unfamiliar to me. It's amazing to me how often manufacturers like Samsung and Sony and Panasonic, how the technical end and the marketing or customer service end, different parts of the company, don't know what the other's doing, and they have no concept. It's like they're separate companies.
Yeah.
Whenever I find that, I just go, what are you guys thinking? It doesn't make any sense at all. But it's a sad fact of this business for some reason. So let me look into it. Let me see what I can find out, because that is going to affect a lot of people, unless it's only the D5300.
It may be.
In which case, it'll only affect a few people.
Right. Depending on how many people have it, I really don't want to buy a new unit just because they crashed it.
No, that's not right. That's not right. Unfortunately, I have heard that Samsung tech support, customer service has not been as good as some other companies.
Yeah.
Sorry to say. Unfortunately, Fushigi in the chat room is saying, get an Oppo. And I have to say that Oppo customer service is top notch. It's a much smaller company. It's here in California. The players are much more expensive. You know, the player you would get is like $500. What did you spend on the 5300? Probably $100.
Yeah, about that.
Something. So, you know, that's five times more money. But they are bulletproof. and the customer service is fantastic. And if they release a firmware update that does something wrong like this, they'll release another one within a week that fixes it. From Premier Radio Network. So,
what I keep telling them to do is take the prior version, renumber it so it's a higher number, and then everything will be fixed.
Yeah, exactly. Good idea. Although that then wouldn't fix the potential problem with the DRM key, as Leah was talking about.
If that's what it is, which could be, but I don't know.
I don't know either. I'm going to find out. It's the current firmware that's on the website right now.
Right.
Leo Laporte, yeah. The tech guy. We'll begin.
Let me look into it, see what I can find out. That's really unfortunate, and I'm sorry you're having that trouble.
We're off the air right now, right?
Well, we're on the stream, but we're off the radio, yeah.
Right. I wanted to give you one more piece of feedback on the first thing that you guys were talking about.
Yeah.
On the TV going dead.
Oh, yeah, uh-huh.
Just to give you the pros and cons, my brother and I both bought the same Samsung TV.
Uh-huh.
They both blew out at about 4 years for a capacitor leaking.
Interesting.
The power supply. I had bought the extended warranty. I got mine replaced on the extended warranty. He didn't have the extended warranty. He had it replaced out of pocket. At 6 years, he got notices on a class action suit that had been filed against Samsung.
Interesting.
To retrieve the money. So I'm not sure which is the pro and con. 10 years later, I'm not sure.
Okay. Thanks so much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Take care. Thank you, Scott. Well, a good day to you, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. We hooked Lee, our last caller of the hour, up with Scott, and I think they've worked it out. Scott's going to check back with his contacts at Samsung. Maybe we can fix this problem. That's what we do here. 8888-ASK-LEO is the phone number. If you have a tech question, problem less interested in problems and more interested in questions. Problems, everybody's got... You got a 99 problems. You got a million of them, right? So, but if you've got a question about technology, computers, the internet, smartphones, home theater, certainly. 8888-ASK-LEO. That's the number. 888-827-5536. I'm just looking. I can't wait to download this app that Scott was talking about, the Z Plus app, and I'm still trying to find it. I guess it is on iTunes as Man of Steel Z Plus. So that might be worth looking into. Man of Steel Z Plus. And by the way, Lee, if you're still listening, somebody in the chat room just told me there is a firmware downgrade for the 5300 available. And we'll put a link, if you can, James DeRuvo is writing this all down. If you can, put a link to that downgrade on our website, techguylabs.com. Techguylabs.com. Let me ask the redoubtable Heather H., who I should talk to next.
Without question. Elizabeth in Lakewood, California.
Without question. Hi, no question. Hi, Elizabeth. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Thanks, Heather.
Hi.
Hey.
I'm about to be a freshman going into high school.
Congratulations. Are you excited?
Yeah.
Graduating from the eighth grade?
Yeah.
Wow. This is exciting. Are you going to, what can I do to help you? You want to get a laptop?
Yeah, but I'm not sure what kind I should get.
Yeah. Yeah, but you should definitely have one.
Yeah.
Did mom or dad give you a budget?
Maybe 100?
100? No. 100?
No, 600.
Oh, 600. Oh, good. I was going to say, oh, dear. 600 we can do. Yeah, there's a lot of good choices in that price range. There's three ways you can go right now. Three different operating systems. There's Mac, there's Windows, and one you should definitely consider is Google's Chromebook. This is the Chrome OS, and it's very simple, but it's probably adequate for high school, maybe even more so. It's very secure. It's inexpensive. We're talking now $250 instead of $600.
Mm-hmm.
And it is basically a Chrome browser. But it's very secure. You can't get hacked in it. For your word processing, you'd use Google Docs. You'd use their word processor or presentation manager. One thing you want to check a little bit, maybe you could ask the high school this summer, is if there are any requirements. For instance, you may take, let's say you take a course in computer-aided design or CAD. Well, that course probably would require you having a Windows machine. Now, they'll have Windows machines in the classroom, but you might want to have one at home as well to run the software.
Yeah.
So Chrome OS is simple and inexpensive, secure, and it's so inexpensive that if you lost it or it got stolen, which is always a risk in school,
yeah,
you could get another one and you'd still under your budget.
Yeah, that's true.
So I'd think about that. There's nothing in the Macintosh world that's anywhere under $1,000. They just announced a Mac Pro for education. The cheapest one is $999. So we're going to eliminate Mac because it's not in your budget.
Yeah.
And there are some pretty good Windows machines for around $600. The budget Windows company is Acer, A-C-E-R. And they make some nice machines for that price if you want to have Windows.
Yeah, I was looking at Windows 8 because I kind of wanted a touchscreen.
Oh, yeah. There's some really good ones. Acer makes one. Let me see what the Lenovo's are costing at this price point. Touchscreen is fantastic. In fact, I don't recommend Windows 8 without it. I'm a big fan of, it's kind of pricey. Shoot. They do make a $600 Lenovo Yoga. That's not a bad. Oh, it's Windows RT. Well, you know what? That may not be a bad way to go. That's the simpler version of Windows.
Yeah.
So that's not a bad one, or even a Microsoft Surface RT. It's not the full Windows, but it's certainly enough for school. It comes with Microsoft Office as part of the price. So that's another one. I like the Lenovo Yoga. Okay, and that's a small portable touchscreen. But they make a couple. They make one for Windows Pro that's much more expensive. But the Windows RT is not too expensive. Another company to look at is Asus, A-S-U-S. They make some excellent Windows laptops. Again, the RT will be less expensive, but I think not a bad choice for you. And Asus is right in that. The Vivo Tab is actually very inexpensive. That's the one you might have seen the ads for, comparing it to the iPad for $450. So those are very nice. I think there's some really excellent choices for you. It's going to be a tough one between Chrome OS and Windows, but you said you want a touchscreen, and I think touchscreen Windows, you're going to want to look at the Lenovo Yoga for Windows RT or the Asus Vivo Tab. Okay. Now, but you should check with the school, because they may say, oh, well, we need you to install some particular kind of software.
Okay.
But I can't imagine they're going to demand that.
All right.
Hey, that's exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah, good luck to you. I think this is a perfect, perfect gift for somebody entering the ninth grade.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're welcome, Elizabeth. Thank your mom and dad, too. Without a computer, you'd really be at a disadvantage, I think, in high school. The ability to do research, to write papers, it makes a huge difference, just to find out what's going on in the world. I think there's some very good choices out there. $600, about the lowest price I'd go with at this point. I wouldn't go too much lower, unless you're getting something like a Chromebook. Hey, good. Have fun. That's exciting. Let's go to Australia, why don't we? David is on the line. Hi, David. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Yes, hi. I am blind and am 16. I have... Basically, I've been trying to work with Xcode and failing really bad because Xcode, is drag and drop.
Yeah, unfortunately, when you're designing the program, that might be a tough one. Boy, that's Apple's very good. Xcode, we should say, for people who don't know, is Apple's free programming environment that comes with OS X. And it's very, very good. But if you're blind, yeah, it might be a little difficult for the drag and drop. For the other stuff, I think it's probably fine. The Apple's come with pretty good accessibility software built in.
Yes, except when they break my Braille display that I own with the iPhone. They've broken it this in the latest 6.13 update.
Oh, that's a drag. So you don't use screen readers, you actually use a Braille display.
I use screen readers, and I have audio output, but then, like, when I'm reading a Kindle book or
it's faster to...
I prefer Braille's to get faster. It in Braille.
Boy, if you've never seen a Braille display, folks, it's the most amazing thing. It's usually a single line, and it's kind of like the reverse of a dot matrix printer. You plug it into the computer, and the text is created in Braille on this strip, which you, David, you leave your fingers on, and it comes up underneath them, right? It's giving you the dots underneath it.
Yes, and actually, as a blind person right now, Android has beat iOS.
Really? Now, this surprises me, because iOS notoriously the best, but you think this 6.3 upgrade is not a good thing.
Actually, if you want, I can go into the next...
Hold on. We're going to take you next break. Thanks. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. This reminds me of... Okay, you know where I went with this? Arrested Development. I don't know why. Because I'm thinking the Final Countdown music, it's a little bit like that, which is Job's magic act. You know what I'm talking about, right? Never mind.
You're right.
That's where I went with that. What is that, Nathan? What is the...
That was one of H-Bomb's picks, Daft Punk.
That's a little Daft Punk. There you go. H-Bomb did it. Thank you, Heather. So we were talking to David. Now, wait a minute. It says in Australia, but you don't sound like you're Australian, David. Where in Australia are you?
I am in Perth, but I'm actually David from... I used to call from Houston.
So you're transplanted to Perth, huh?
Yes, pretty much.
For how long are you going to be there?
4 years.
Do you like it?
Oh, it's the best.
You're on the west coast of Australia. Kind of, yes. Yeah.
My biggest problem is I can't find geek blind people. I really can't.
Oh, come on. There's got to be some in Perth.
In Perth, there's the Cisco Academy, but the problem with them is if you aren't in their classes, you're counted as dirt.
Oh, that's too bad. Well, they should embrace you. If you find a geek, you know what you could do? You could start a user group for blind geeks, David, in the Perth Blind Geeks Users Group. PBGUG. PBGUG.
Yeah, we're already working on that.
Good. Good.
My favorite thing to do is teach blind people how to use their technology properly.
That's awesome. And I think the Braille reader and the using the voice access, that's great. I'm just, you know, I don't know what the answer is to your question, which is how do I get Xcode to be more friendly? Tell me, though, the reason I brought you back, I wanted to hear a little bit more about iPhone versus Android. You feel that Android's accessibility has surpassed the iPhone?
So for me, there's two reasons I like it. First, the Android's got VoiceOver only gets updated when Apple pushes out an update. Which is not very often.
Right.
And the problem is there's problems found in VoiceOver. With Windows, I've got a screen reader called Job Access with Speech. I'm sure you've
heard
people talk about it.
Sure.
And they should push out an update maybe once a week because there's things that you just find that you in.
But even, you know, it's so funny because you probably heard John McCain when Tim Cook, the CEO of Apple, was testifying before the Senate committee. At the end of the testimony, John McCain said, "I guess I got one thing for you. Why does my iPhone updating all the time?" I guess so.
I listened to the hero.
Maybe older folks don't want so many updates, David. You young people, you can handle all the updates.
Well, then put VoiceOver as a separate update.
I agree. It should be separate. It is on Android, isn't it? It's a separate application.
Yeah. And the thing is with me being a geek, and I load public betas of it, and I've ROMed Android devices. I've rooted them. It's just...
Well, I'm just glad to hear that. In fact, I hope... Are you doing a blog or anything that you let people know around the world? Because it's not just Perth. People around the world probably want to know what you're doing.
I've got a website. I've worked on blogging.
What's the website?
I'm not a very...
Do you want to promote it?
Sure. DavidTheTechGuy.com. Hope it doesn't.
No, I don't own the tech guy. That's awesome. DavidTheTechGuy.com. David, I wish you all the best. I'm so glad, so good to hear from you. Stay in touch, okay?
Thank you so much.
All right, David. Take care. John in Prescott Valley, Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, John.
Hey, thanks for taking the call. I appreciate it.
My pleasure.
What I'm doing, I'm the videographer for our church, and I record a lot of events and things at the church, put them on YouTube. I'm kind of looking at upgrading my video camera and just want a little bit of advice because, as you know, you can't really go into any stores now and
I know. Video cameras and standalone GPSs overnight have been replaced by your smartphone in many cases. Certainly, still cameras do very good jobs with video as well. And even professional videographers now have moved to digital still cameras like the Canon 5D Mark III and the D800 from Nikon because it gives you great high-def video and you get better choices of lenses than you'd ever get in a camcorder. However...
That's what I've thought about, because I do have a Nikon D300S.
Well, you may just use that. Now, you probably can't do long clips, right?
Yeah, that's the problem I run into. You know, we've got some concerts and other things we do. And, right. And I know even, you know, I've even looked at going with a D600, and, you know, you're kind of limited to 20, 30 minutes.
Yeah, almost all of them. Believe it or not, the pickups overheat. They're really not designed for long shooting. Now, that works great for a lot of people. You know, if you're making YouTube videos, that's fine. But for a church, you want to have a sermon. And if the preacher goes on and on and on, you want to say, Reverend, could you stop talking? I gotta restart the camera.
So you might want to, but
you're not allowed to. So we use Canon Vixias, V-I-X-I-A's. We're very happy. In fact, we got Vixias throughout the studio. I bought about 40 of them. We just got the newest model. What's the new model, John? HFT G20. We had G10s. The new HF G20 just came out. And what are they, about $1,200? $1,000. They've gotten a lot cheaper. When we bought them, they were $1,500. Now, that may be, I don't know if that's out of your price range or not, but these are excellent high-def cameras. If you're looking at our Twitch stream right now, that's what you're looking at.
Okay. And does it have an actual viewfinder? Because that's the other
issue I run into. It has a nice 3.5-inch LCD that's gorgeous. Oh, you mean like a through the eyepiece? Yeah, it's got that too.
Oh, it does. Great.
It's electronic. I mean, well, of course it is. It's not optical, but no, I don't think any video camera has optical. Maybe the high-end ones do.
All right.
Hey, highly recommended. Yeah, by our studio manager, Jammer B, John Bacon Slanina. Does the B in Jammer B stand for bacon? No. All right. Leo, I saw a poster the other day. What was it? It says, Bob Hope has passed, Johnny Cash has passed, Steve Jobs has passed. Now we have no hope, no cash, no jobs. Let's just hope Kevin Bacon doesn't die. Bacon joke. Geeks love bacon. Got to throw one in once in a while. Michael in Laurel, Maryland. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Hey, Leo. How you doing?
I am well. How are you?
I am having all kinds of fun. My lovely wife, Julie, turned me on to you when we first started dating. We almost invited you to the wedding, but we didn't think you were all the way to the East Coast.
How sweet is that? When was the wedding?
It was November 2010.
Oh, that's great. And I haven't broken the two of you up yet, huh? That's wonderful.
No.
That's a geek wedding, a geek marriage.
Well, we are both geeks. So,
sometimes we get mixed marriages. You know, you get Apple and Windows, and that's not good. So I hope you guys are...
This is a mixed marriage because she's a Microsoft like SQL Server geek, and I'm a Linux guy.
So. Oh, dear. That is a mixed marriage. She's a little Android. I'm a little iPhone. It's dangerous. Boy, you got to... No, that's fun. I love it.
No, we both proudly carry hacked Android phones with custom prompts on them.
Right on. Right on, right on, right on. Well, if you're a Linux geek, there's probably not much I can do to help you, Michael. What's your question?
Well, the thing is, I don't know a whole lot about projectors. In fact, I know nothing about projectors.
All right, hang on. We're going to take a break. I hear the magic music. Okay. We will come back. We'll talk about, you mean projectors for watching movies or for PowerPoint stuff?
For a presentation.
All right, we'll talk about it when we come back. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Leo Laporte is the tech guy. Johnny Jett is the travel guy, johnnyjett.com. Hey, Johnny, happy birthday.
Oh, my God, thank you.
It was yesterday. Did you have a great time?
I sure did. You know where I am?
Are you celebrating somewhere? Let's see. Let's look out the window.
All right, you
ready?
This
is great on the radio. I'm going to describe it. The sky is blue. The clouds are white. The buildings are tall. And I see the Toronto CN Tower in the background. That's the dead giveaway.
That's right.
Yeah, that's great. You're staying real near it, too.
I'm at the Ritz-Carlton across the street.
Fancy.
I'm speaking at the biggest travel bloggers conference.
Wow, what fun.
And they put me up here, which is very nice. And actually, one of your regulars was one of the keynotes.
Who's that? Amber MacArthur?
No, another guy, photographer.
Chris Marquardt is there.
No, Trey.
Trey Ratcliffe. Oh, he's a superstar.
Yep.
He's a superstar. Yeah, Trey Ratcliffe. He moved to New Zealand. He travels more than you do because all his work is in the Northern Hemisphere. He has to fly all over the place.
I asked him that question. I was like, why would you move to New Zealand if you travel so much? It's the most remote place you can.
He says, I can live anywhere I want.
Well, good for him.
And when you see the pictures from New Zealand, you can see why he lives. He lives in Queenstown, which is gorgeous. Yeah.
And I love New Zealand and Queenstown.
Yeah. Queenstown, they say, is kind of an upscale. It's kind of like the Carmel of Down Under.
It is a very nice place. I was there last year. And actually, not Queenstown, but close, Queensland. I'm actually doing a contest with them right now, but it's for bloggers. You have to write a blog post, 500 words or less.
That's Australia.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. Is that on JohnnyJet.com?
It is. It's on the homepage.
Great. So what do you want to talk about today, Johnny? Johnny's here always to help us get better travel deals, to have better travel experiences using the computer.
Well, I got a couple of fun things. One is one of your readers emailed me, or viewers, and asked me if there is a website out there that shows the list of airlines that offer free alcohol.
Well, we know where his priorities are.
And I'm like, all right, that's got to be coming from Leo's people. So anyway, I found a website. It's called Map Happy. So maphappy.org. And if you click to the right where it says popular posts, the ultimate list of airlines that serve free alcohol, and they just updated it recently.
And they've got a very scary picture of Richard Branson of Virgin Atlantic dressed up as one of his stewardesses, lipstick and all.
Well, he lost a contest with the guy from Air Asia, the CEO. They had some kind of bet, and Richard lost, so he had to go on that guy's airline and serve on a flight from Sydney to Kuala Lumpur.
You gotta love Richard Branson. That is a guy with a good sense of humor.
He's amazing. I mean, I told you the time he toured me around his island, Necker Island.
No. Man, wow, you got some friends in high places. I have to say, Virgin America, which is the American, and it doesn't fly to very many places, Boston, San Francisco, a few. It is the way to fly if you can. I love Virgin America.
They always win. They just won. They just came out again with the top award for the best domestic airline. The problem with Virgin America is they're not making money. So everyone's wondering if they're going to be around in five years or less.
Not many of them are making money. And one of the reasons Virgin America is so nice is because it's brand new. So they have new planes. It's all fancy.
But they have great technology, which I'm sure all your readers and viewers
The thing in the seat backs, you mean? What do they call that? The red?
The in-flight entertainment, the red system.
Yeah, I
love
that. You
can order your food, your drinks on demand, which I love.
Yeah.
And you can also do seat chat now. You know, you can.
That's
you can
the buy strangest thing. You ever do that? You can chat with anybody else in the airplane. You say, hey, I want to chat with that good-looking fellow over there at 23C. And and you can start typing. Now, of course, he can ignore you.
That's right.
It's very strange. You can send them a drink. Hey, I'm going to send a drink to that girl in 28B.
All right, so I got another website for
just
you.
That's great. You can't escape these hit artists on the airplane. They're there. You're going to be with them for 8 hours. Oh, great. Anyway, go ahead, Johnny. What else?
Okay, one of the guys in a chat room last week or 2 weeks ago suggested Plane Finder, which I knew about, but I never really checked it out that
What's
much.
What's that for?
So go to planefinder.com.
All right.
.net. And you're going to see all the planes that, most of the planes, especially over North America and Europe right now.
These are actual flights going on right now. It looks like autumn leaves falling all over.
It is. And if you, you click one, and it will tell you, you know, what the airline is, where it's traveling from,
really
the registration,
cool.
the altitude.
Oh, man. There are 10,295 visible planes right now.
In the air.
In the air.
And this is only, you know, partial because it doesn't cover all the, it doesn't cover Africa, I don't think, or a lot of places in Africa, in South America.
But if you look out the window and there's a plane flying over, you could go to planeflinder.net and
say, zoom in.
What is that zoom plane? In. Yeah. Wow. So, this is really neat.
Yeah, I love it. And especially for people who are either afraid to fly because they're like, you know, one of the things when I used to be afraid to fly, which by the way, I was.
Really?
You know, yeah, I was, you couldn't get me on a plane between the ages of 18 and 21.
Wow.
And I got over my fear.
How? How did you get over it?
It's a long story, but part of it is just realizing that it's so much safer to fly and that these planes are always up in the air. Because, you know, you only think it's the planes are up in the air when you're flying.
Right, but there's planes flying all the time. There's thousands, tens of thousands of them.
Tens of thousands
and,
all the time.
You know, you don't hear about them falling out of the sky like leaves.
No, but that was one of the things. Also, going to the airport, by the way, and pretending I was going to get on a flight also helped me.
Did you, do you notice that the more you fly, the more comfortable you are or the less comfortable you are?
I'd say more comfortable.
I went through a stage when I was flying a lot where I actually got scared-er. And then I went to that map site, Happy, maphappy.org, and I got happy, and I don't have to worry anymore. No, I don't mind anymore. I don't have any fear of flying.
You know, I don't like the small planes, and I'm actually going to...
Yeah, I don't like small planes.
A couple of weeks, I'm going to be in a remote part of the world, and I'm going to have to be jumping on these small planes, and I'm not looking forward to that.
And I will not get in a helicopter, ever.
I've been in a helicopter a bunch of times, but actually in Queenstown last year, I'd never been more scared. I was up 6,000 feet, and the guy is like, oh, we'll go higher. I'm like, no, you don't have to go higher. My hands were sweating so much.
Yeah, I don't... They're ballistic, you know. They don't... If the rotor stops, they fall like a rock.
Yeah. It's like, hello.
At least a plane, you have a shot at gliding to the ground. I don't know. I just won't go in helicopters. It's just a superstition, I guess. I just won't do it. I don't mind a hot air balloon, and that's the same problem, you know.
I'm going on one of those in 2 weeks, too.
Yeah. Well, there you go. JohnnyJet.com. A couple of great sites. I like that. MapHappy.com has an article on all the free booze on airplanes and a picture of Richard Branson in lipstick. That's just bonus material. And then I love this. PlaneFinder.net. This is really, really neat. What an amazing...
Good. Well, glad you like it.
Yeah. What an amazing site. If you want to know more about Johnny, he had his little party yesterday on the Twitter. You do that every Friday. Great way to, you know, ask questions and win prizes. What time is that Twitter combo?
Every Friday at 12 noon Eastern, and travel skills is a hashtag.
12 noon Eastern, hashtag travel skills. And, of course, JohnnyJet.com. Follow him on Twitter, at JohnnyJet. You're the best.
All right.
You're the best.
Leo, thanks.
Thanks, Johnny. Happy
me.
Birthday. I hope you're having a great time.
Oh, I'm having the best birthday.
Yeah. Well, your wife lives in Toronto, so it's a convenient coincidence that the travel blog thing is up there. And boy, that Ritz-Carlton, there's Natalie. That Ritz-Carlton is a nice hotel. Wow. That must be a new hotel. I don't remember that being there in Toronto when I used to go there.
It is. It's a year and a half or 2 years old. They have a bunch of new luxury hotels here. They have the Trump, they have the Shangri-La that just opened, and the Four Seasons.
Man.
That just reopened.
Wow.
And, so come on back.
And the chat room is saying, helicopters, they're no problem. They auto-rotate safely to the ground when they lose power. I don't want to be in it.
I'm going to the chat room right now. Thanks
Please
for having
say
me.
Hi to him. Thank you, Johnny Jet. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. More of your calls still to come. Stay here. 8888. Ask Leo. We're flying into the danger zone. No helicopters. Gliders I don't mind. I don't know why, but I don't mind gliders. But I don't like helicopters. Don't do small planes. Don't do Blue Angels either. Just in case anybody's asking. 8888-ASK. Nobody's asking. Ask Leo. We were talking to Michael. He's a Linux geek, but he's got a question about projectors. What do you need a projector for, Michael?
Well, I'm presenting at the National Guild of Hypnotists in a couple of months.
Are you a professional hypnotist?
I am a professional hypnotist.
Are you like a stage hypnotist, or are you a you do it for?
No, I don't do stage. I do good old ordinary. Come into my office, and we'll get you to break a bad habit.
That I need that. My mom says she swears that's how she stopped smoking.
I've gotten a lot of people off smoking that way. Yeah,
that's awesome. Maybe I'll take up smoking, and then you can help me stop.
I'm sure we can come up with a better excuse than that.
There, I have other bad habits. I'll find one for you. So that's great. So now they'll have a projector there, probably.
No, they don't. They're kind of low tech. They have the old fashioned overhead projector where you print everything out on transparencies and put them down. And I really don't want to go that way. I want to be.
You're
able to
kidding me.
YouTube clips. What?
Where do you even get one of those?
Apparently, they've got them stockpiled.
Overhead projectors like they used in school.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, or the good old-fashioned paper easel.
No kidding. How many people are you going to be talking to? Five?
Probably about 30.
Oh, 30 to 50. Piece of paper. Now, as you can see here on the pad of paper.
Yes.
Yeah, so you need a projector. Now, how big is the room?
I don't want a projector. The room, typically, I won't know until I get there, but most of the meeting rooms that we hold these things in are probably like 20 feet deep.
So it's not huge.
It's like a section of a ballroom.
Yeah, it's not huge. Yeah. And you can, I presume, darken it.
Yes, we can darken it.
And you want to darken a room full of hypnotists? That seems dangerous. You're getting
anytime
sleepy.
Anytime you get us together in mass quantities, it's dangerous. We mess with each other in some very amusing ways.
What do you use in your practice? What do you use to get people to go to sleep? Do you swing a watch in front of them? What do you do?
I have one. I've only ever used it once because I have a hard time doing it and keeping a straight face.
I have an
arsenal of different spoken type injunctions that I'll use depending on what the personality is of the person I'm working with.
I went to a hypnotist for a long time to do weight loss, and he could never get me under. He had a prism. He had all sorts of stuff. So he hit me on the head. Nothing. I don't know why, but I think some people are not so susceptible to it, right? We just can't let go.
It's not about susceptibility, really. It's about willingness.
Yeah.
Pretty much anybody barring certain types of physical brain damage.
I tried really hard. I really wanted to go under. I wanted it to work.
Maybe you were trying too hard. It happens.
Maybe that was it. I wasn't relaxed enough.
Mm. So I'm going to do these presentations, and I am looking for a projector. Ideally, I would either be plugging it into my laptop or actually better, my Android tablet, because I've got an HDMI interface. The laptop is only VGA.
Perfect.
I don't know anything about projectors, though.
There are a couple of companies that make projectors that are very widely used. I happen to be an Epson fan. When I buy these, there's two kinds of projectors. There's home theater projectors, and there's PowerPoint. I call them PowerPoint projectors. In your case, obviously, it won't be PowerPoint. And of course, you understand you need the MHL adapter and for your phone and all of that stuff.
No, I don't understand that. What's NHL adapter?
MHL. Well, if you're already getting HDMI out, you know this.
Okay. The tablet has HDMI out. The laptop only has VGA out.
Right. The tablet, though, probably needs a special cable to get the HDMI.
It's a little tiny micro HDMI, yeah. There's an adapter.
That's the MHL adapter.
Oh, okay.
So you can get, it's $1.99 on Amazon. They're cheap.
Okay.
You know, yes. As Low Tech in our chat room says, you need a little converter thingy. And you get the right converter thingy for your laptop. There's companies like InFocus. There's lots of great choices. You won't be spending more than a few hundred dollars on this. It's worth probably getting a decent one, because if you're going to use it again. You don't have to spend a lot of money, though. I mean, what you're thinking, here's what you're looking at. Here's the specs you're looking at. Throw, which is how close to the back wall or front wall the projector can be. In a smaller room, you need a special, the projector needs to have special capabilities. Otherwise, you'll see a teeny weeny thing on the wall. So that's one thing, is the throw distance, and the other is the lumens, which is the brightness that you want.
Okay.
And if the darker you can make the room, the better, you'll be able to do with lumens. You don't need as bright a projector if you can make the room darker. If you go to the Epson site, they actually have a projector finder that will at least give you a sense of what it is that you're looking for. You could start with the room type. I'm going to pick small to medium room. You could choose ultra mobile, which I wouldn't. Those are Pico projectors. They're fit in your pocket. Get the portable projectors, probably sufficient.
And, I've seen the little tiny ones.
Yeah, that's called a Pico. Right. You don't need a Pico projector.
No, I'm not going to fly to the place, but something I can carry would be fine. Yeah.
And you're talking, you know, some of these are kind of pricey, but I think, you know, you probably don't have to spend more than the few hundred bucks for this. I would look at one that is an LCD projector. That's pretty common now.
Okay.
$399 for the Powerlite S11. That's a 3 LCD. 3 is better color reproduction. The brightness is 2,600 lumens. That's probably more than enough for your setup. But you can even get less expensive if you want. So those are Epsons, but as people have said, InFocus makes some good ones. There's a variety of different ones.
Okie dokie.
If it is a micro HDMI port on the laptop, on the tablet, as some are saying, you don't need any special adapter. You just need a micro HDMI cable.
Yeah, it's an Acer Iconia A500.
Oh, okay. So that is a micro. You do have a micro HDMI coming out of it. Some of the, like the Nexus, you'll have, it looks like a USB plug, but it does have HDMI. You just need a special adapter. But yeah, micro, but now I can almost promise you that the projector will not come with the micro HDMI adapter, so you'll want to get an adapter for that. But those are cheap. Sounds good. I'm getting a little sleepy. A little sleepy. I'm tempted to try it again. Try it again. I went 10 times. Never got me under. Alan in Long Beach, California. You're next. Hi, Alan. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Hi, Leo. I'm calling because I have an old video camera that uses mini DV. And since then, I've upgraded computers or replaced computers, and I have a laptop and a desktop, and neither one has a FireWire port, which is the only way to get video.
I know. Isn't that awful?
Yes.
So is this a tape video camera?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. And the newer video cameras all use memory, little memory cards. You could pop the card and use a card reader, but of course you need the FireWire to get the video out.
Right.
Of a tape camera. There's no other way to do it.
Yeah, and I'm trying to figure, everybody says, well, it has USB 2, so you just get an adapter, but it's not, that's not going to work.
No, yeah, and that's really more for pulling the still pictures off.
Yeah.
For video, you really do need FireWire. Now, you can get FireWire adapter thingies. So what does your computer have right now? It has USB?
Yeah, it has USB 2 and it has other ports. Like I think the laptop has some kind of an HDMI port, and the desktop has a card reader. You know, I'm not sure what else.
Is there a PCI card slot or a PC or a card bus slot on the laptop?
Yeah, I thought of that too. And no.
There's
and
not.
I actually called. I have a Toshiba satellite, and I actually called them to see if there was a way I could pull out.
That's the best way to do it, by the way, because the reason that you're not really going to do FireWire to USB is it's not fast enough.
Right.
And you need, for all that data coming in off video, you need to capture it in real time, and it needs to be fast enough because the tape's not going to slow down.
Yeah.
To wait for you.
Yeah, and I had the problem initially because the camera actually has a USB port on it. But before I had the FireWire, I tried USB. I think it was USB 1. That's how old the camera
is.
Won't
work.
And
here's the deal. The camera is actually an analog recorder. The FireWire output just is an analog to digital. I believe it is. What kind of tape is it?
Mini DV.
Oh, it might be. It is digital video. It's not analog. It's digital.
Yeah.
So I was going to suggest an analog capture device like the ADVC-110 from Pinnacle, but...
Yeah.
You'd like to get it off digitally. We got to take a break. Hold on. When I come back, I'll have some answers. You just take your answer off the air if you don't mind. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. He's going to have to do a FireWire card in his desktop. That's the only way to do it. The tech guy here to tell you about a brand new feature for Ring Central customers. Ring Central. I love low-tech's answer. You need a thingy. A converter thingy. Yeah, I think the only way to do this is to get a PCI card for his desktop. It's Ring Central, the ultimate cloud phone system. I have on my I have Pizzizz on my iPhone, P-Z-I-Z-Z, and that is neuro-linguistic programming. So Pizzizz plays these trancy music that you listen to, and you're supposed to take a nap, and then the voice says things like, "You're a good person. Life is going to be easy for you. You will be very happy." And like that over and over again. Didn't do much for me. But it helped me sleep. Look at my screensaver. This is a Linux screensaver. It's one of those light, fiber optics. Yeah, it's cool, huh? Zombo.com. See if Pizzizz has a sample. If I had my iPhone here, I could generate it for you. By the way, I did find that app, and it's only on the iPhone right now. Scott did say they were going to do an Android version, so I'll bring my iPhone in tomorrow. We can try it tomorrow.
We could try it on mine.
Oh, you got an iPhone?
What kind of headphones do we need, though?
Regular headphones.
Not earbuds.
I'll show you the app. Earbuds are fine, but we have good headphones too. You could use. It was hard to find. But I found it thanks to the chat room. I searched for. It was Dark Night Rises. Dot. Why? It's not. It's doing it again. Typing. I'm typing here. Stupid piece of crumb bum.
Sorry, I put in Man of Steel Z Plus.
No, that's not it.
Oh.
Do Dark Knight Rises dot on your browser, rjdj.me.
My word.
And then this is what you'll get. Now you don't have to do it. Just watch this. Now this is what you get. And that way you go to darkknightrises.rjdj.me. We'll give you a link to the App Store. And I'll show you what it is on the App Store. Yes, by real... This isn't right.
I can't just go to the App
this
Store.
This isn't right. Oh, yeah, this is it. By Reality Jockey Limited. No, this is not it. This can't be it. This is not it.
That's not it.
Because Scott said, no, they didn't do it for... It's only for Man of Steel.
Yeah.
Not it.
Well, yeah.
Not it. You think it's it, but it's not it. It's from DTS. So it will be out eventually, I guess.
Psh. Do you remember Priscilla Thorner?
I know that name. Why do I know that name?
If I say lawyer, does that do anything?
Is she a friend of the lawyer?
She is a lawyer.
She is a lawyer.
She's got the legal skills, but she's not like a go-to-court lawyer. She's
a radio lawyer.
She worked at Tech TV, and I guess she got some clearances for one of your books or did some.
Yeah, that's where I know the name. Yeah.
And now she works at The Gap, you know, same thing.
She works at The Gap?
Licensing and whatnot for various clothing in different countries.
Oh, that's neat.
But we know
you know her, friend of yours?
Back when, yeah, from like the music industry or whatever, because she used to do that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And there was a sort of women in music tech mixer thing.
Oh, neat.
Wednesday night.
How was the? How was Kevin Systrom? Was he interesting?
Oh, yeah, that was really good.
Yeah.
It was entertaining, and I liked finding out that they're good people, you know?
Oh, yeah, he's really great. They're really not, like him.
Yeah, they're not.
No, he was. There was two people for a long time.
Yeah.
No, that was a nice success.
They only have like 16 engineers, and now they've grown to 34 people or something.
Yeah. It's kind of a neat story.
And they want to keep it really simple. Yeah. And.
Well, and I was talking to my son and his friends. They're all 18. We're going to the graduation today at Petaluma High, and we were talking about Facebook and how everybody's using Instagram and Snapchat right now, and they're pretty savvy. They knew.
Like instead?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's why they had to buy Instagram. It was defensive.
Right.
Yeah.
And they're very interested and focused on communities now, I think. And they said, like, hashtag knitting.
Yeah.
In but and you of know itself what? Has hundreds and thousands of pictures.
Yeah. It'll be great.
For knitting.
Until something else comes along, and then it'll be greater.
Yeah.
Nothing lasts, unfortunately, especially in social. Because it's where your friends are, and they move like a school of fish, you know?
Right. No, that's exactly the image that I've had.
Yeah. And so you can't, you know, how are you going to predict where a school of fish is going next? You can't. But again, yeah. One thing you can predict, they aren't going to stay where they are.
You're sure of that?
Oh, yeah.
Because I think when you really, really hit the nail on the head and do something,
which they did,
love,
Instagram's amazing.
That they will.
I was a very early adopter.
Perhaps.
No.
No? Nope. Okay. Are you Vining?
Yeah, my son's so into Vine.
I love Vine.
He won't get an Android like phone. He loves my HTC One and really thinks it's the best thing in the world, but because Vine's not on it, he said that's a deal breaker.
Oh, my God. Oh, okay, and you were talking about Arrested Development.
Yeah.
Did you see the one where, this is my
I'm just
favorite
catching
thing.
Up. I've only seen like 20 episodes. I've only seen the first year.
Oh, the
year.
Old one.
Yeah.
Oh, you're not into the new season.
I haven't even watched the old ones, all the old ones yet.
Oh, it's so good. Never mind, then.
Never mind.
Not like there's
so you like the new ones.
I do. I cannot believe people are slagging on it at all.
Yeah, because a lot of the review, I haven't seen it yet, but a lot of the reviews are it's not good. I'm watching the old ones, too. I'm up to 29. I'm just catching up. Oh, Heather, you got a Google Plus. I love that. I must add you to my circles.
Do it. I've gotten
a
lot of Twit followers.
I'm
going to
put you in Twit and what else should I put you in? Staff
regular
and
public?
Sexy.
Oh. What? You don't have that category.
I have a circle
you
called
weirdo.
Sexy. Why not?
Please, show, please hold.
So you've seen Henry Winkler.
Oh, there was this great moment where Henry Winkler is the lawyer and he goes in the bathroom. He's going to comb his hair and he goes.
Oh, that's good.
Wasn't
that's
a great
good.
Moment?
It's like one of my favorite things.
Yeah,
of all time.
Me too. Yeah, no, it's so funny. It was such a, and it was so quick. It was just a real quick, it was a blackout. The only thing I don't like about Arrested Development, it still gets on my nerves, is the narration. I wish, the narration is so annoying.
I don't like it.
Well, it's constant.
Leo Laporte, the tech guy, will begin at 6 minutes past the hour.
Oh, yeah? The narrator has a joke? Oh, good.
But it's Opie.
The narrator's Ron Howard?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. Well, I might like it better now.
Oh, it's so good.
It gets me annoyed a little bit, because it's like, I don't like, exposition. And that's all they use the narration for. It's really a bunch of blackout scenes with the narrator stitching them together. And I feel like that's a little cheap.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
But it's okay. It's very funny. I'm not, it's just like laughing blackout scenes. You know? Knox Arrington says, it's like complaining there are too many spaceships on Star Trek. I understand. I understand. I'm not saying it would be better without it. It wouldn't exist without it. But it's something that bugs me about the show. Well, hey, how are you today? Leo Laporte, the tech guy. 8888-ASK-LEO, that's the number. 888-827-5536. Toll free from anywhere in the U.S. We were talking before the break with Alan in Long Beach, who has an old camcorder. You know, a nice mini DV camcorder. It was kind of the last of the tape camcorders. The problem is, the way you got video off those, you had a FireWire cable, which you would plug in to your computer. If you were lucky, your video editing software would say, oh, I see the camera, and then you'd have controls on the screen, rewind, play, record, and all that stuff. So you just say, import all the video, and the computer would do the rest. Problem is, FireWire's kind of disappeared. The good news is, and I think the only recommendation I think I could stand by, you don't want to, you could get an analog to digital video converter, an ADVC, but that will downgrade the video and then upgrade it. It will convert it to analog, then back to digital. And since you have digital video recording capability on those mini DV tapes, they're digital, let's not do the conversion. Let's get some FireWire. So if you have a Windows PC, you can buy a FireWire card. You need a desktop, you know, one with slots. They're not very expensive. A lot of companies make them. You get them on Amazon. Use it for importing. I wouldn't keep using that recorder, probably. You'd want to go to the newer recorders that records directly to flash media. Makes it a lot easier. So I guess the only really good way to do this is to get a FireWire card, to add the FireWire capability to your PC. It's too bad, but that's the way technology moves, way too fast in many cases. You know, it's a mixed blessing. Because it moves so fast, we get great new stuff all the time. But it's also a little bit depressing because you always have to get great new stuff. In fact, companies, I think, are challenged by this. Apple is currently a little bit challenged, right? Apple's got to figure out what to do about the next iPhone because they only put out new iPhones once a year, and there's new Android phones every 5 minutes. So lots of upgrades all the time. It's a mixed blessing. It's good and it's bad. Let's say hi to Nell in Highland, California. Hi, Nell. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Hi, Leo. You know, I was thinking that if people can hear you during the commercial, they would see how much fun you were having.
We do have fun during the commercial. And because you were on hold, yes. you heard all our secrets.
Yes, I did. I'm calling about my Toshiba Thrive tablet, AT100. It's an Android 4.0, and I really, really like it. It's just that when I go to download anything big, doesn't matter if it's PDF or one of the apps, I have to use the Wi-Fi from my cheap 3.0 phone or go sit at the parking lot of Staples or something. Don't laugh, Lee.
I'm not. No. I'm laughing with you. Not
you
at.
Know,
so you don't.
You know, I see so many people at
in the parking lot.
In the parking lots, it is so funny.
That's hysterical. That's the new thing, isn't it? Just sit out, find an open Wi-Fi access spot, sit outside. So you don't have Wi-Fi at home or at work so that you can use. You have to go somewhere and borrow some Wi-Fi.
I have a big tablet or a big notebook at my job, but I have the Ethernet hooked up to it.
Got
but
it.
No, I don't have
it. Yeah. A lot of businesses don't want to do wireless because they want to control for the exact yeah. reason that you go to Staples parking lot because they want to control who has access to it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because I'll be using it up.
Yeah.
So I was just, my question is there a standard Ethernet cable USB adapter where I can just plug in the Ethernet cable to one side and then the USB into the Toshiba Thrive.
Yeah, so you like an Ethernet adapter for the Thrive.
Yeah. Since the Toshiba Thrive already has the regular USB port.
Right. It seems like you could get a USB Ethernet adapter. And really, the hardware isn't the problem. It's an issue of the software, the driver. And the only way this would work, and I have to do some research to see, the only way this would work is if Toshiba put software on the Thrive that said, oh, I see you're using an Ethernet adapter. Let me connect that up for you.
Okay.
It looks like they do.
Okay.
It looks like they do. I see a number of ways to do this. Here's one called the Bob J. Gear. It's for Android tablets. It's an Ethernet adapter. Wow.
And what is it called?
Well, I don't, you know, I'm not going to say go out and buy this. I'm just seeing that it exists.
Okay.
It is only $18. It's the Bob, B-O-B-J, Gear. Never heard of this company in a million years. But they make it. Okay. It says it's for the Thrive. But you're going to need another adapter to go with it. In fact, they sell the Bob J. Gear Android tablet cable adapter set to go with it, which costs as much as the adapter. There may be other less expensive ways. Here's one from Pluggable Technologies. The real issue is, in other words, we can do the physical connection. The real issue is, will the Thrive see it? And I think it will. I think it supports what we call on-the-go, USB on-the-go, or OTG. And that makes it capable of understanding what's going on. So that's okay. Good news. Yeah. So you just I'm seeing one from Pluggable Technologies. All of these end in a standard USB port, which you would then need to connect up using a USB OTG cable.
Okay, I see you. I see the Twit Live there.
Ah, yeah, I'm showing it on the screen at Amazon.com.
Yes.
So you'll see I'm showing the Bob J, and then when Amazon shows it to you, they say frequently bought together, and then they show the cable adapters that you need to make this work.
I
would do a search on Toshiba Thrive Ethernet and see what kind of if there's additional hardware or software that you need.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there's an app you need to install, because I haven't tried this, but in theory this is doable. It's really not about the hardware. You can get the hardware to work. It's the software. It's the drivers, so that the so that the tablet says, oh yeah, I'm getting internet now. And, you're going to do this at work, or you want to do this at home?
I want to do this at home, and I don't have any internet or anything like that. So
Well, what are you going to connect it to if you're going to do it at home? You need something to connect the Ethernet to.
Oh, I'm sorry. I misunderstood your question.
Oh, you're going to do it at work?
I'm doing it from work.
Yeah. So that may be another issue. You should check with work to make sure that they won't block this kind of thing.
Well, I'm part owner, so there's...
Oh, well, in that case, tell the IT guy to do it for you.
Yes, the IT guy would be the other partner.
Is your hubby? Yeah, you tell him, I need Ethernet.
That's right.
Hey, it's great to talk to you. Thanks, Nell.
Thank you very much for your help.
Yeah, if you're part owner, then you don't have to worry too much. Just should probably put Wi-Fi in the business. Just get a little Wi-Fi hub. Tell your IT guy / partner to get the... I need Wi-Fi. I'm tired of going out there getting all this extra hardware. The Thrive does support Ethernet. The Bob J gear is one of the devices it supports. We'll put a link in the show notes. Thank you, Hamilton, in the chat room. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. 8888-ASK-LEO, that's the number. If you want to talk high tech. Did you see this? Chicago Sun-Times firing all their photojournalists, every one of them. You know, but
unbelievable.
All this time we say, oh, the media's dying, newspapers are dying, the internet's taking over. And then when newspapers do what dying businesses do, lay people off, we freak out. Well, buy a newspaper, kids, and maybe, you know, this won't happen. Here's the weird thing. I thought maybe they're going to replace staff photojournalists with freelancers. You know, because remember in Spider-Man? Remember in Spider-Man where, like, he had pictures of Spider-Man and they bought them from him, right? Tobey Maguire did. It's like that. It's freelance. And I think a lot of newspapers probably use freelance photographers. But no, it's not. I can't believe this. They're training their reporters to use iPhones to take pictures for the paper now. What?
Mind-blowing. Yeah, those will be good.
The point that a lot of people have made is actually twofold. First off, these photographers are not just like, you know, monkeys. They're skilled professionals, and they're photojournalists. They're journalists. They're not just like the guy who goes along with a reporter. They're journalists. But I also have to point out, I and many others in this business have been saying, you see, the end of the music industry. We're revamping how we get information. We're not reading newspapers. Well, that's what happens. People lose their jobs. Businesses go under.
But they
do we need newspapers?
Wrong, right?
Well,
we do, but they need to monetize it online, right?
Yeah, but there's not enough money online. That's the problem. Chicago Sun-Times is a great newspaper. You know, I think one of the issues that people forget is the reason newspapers even exist. They were invented more than 100 years ago as a place to put big ads. You know, the full page Macy's ad?
I didn't realize that.
That you see in the newspapers? Yeah.
I thought they really
display
wanted to
ads
get the news out.
Created newspapers, not the other way around. And and so when display advertising stopped being as lucrative as it used to be because people advertise on the internet, and when classified ads, which really kind of prop up newspapers and have for years, moved to Craigslist. If you want to pick one villain, it's Craigslist. Craigslist put newspapers out of business.
Oh, right.
Because you just can't make as much money online. So. I shouldn't laugh. I feel for these guys, and they're all great. And, you know, if they're good photographers and they're smart, they will find a way, I think, to make a living.
Yeah. Well, you're never... Oh, right, the photographers who were fired. But the poor reporter, how they're never going to get that beautiful wide-angle lens shot. You're never going to get
with
those
an
shots
iPhone.
Of the Blue Angels.
You're going to have lots of pictures of little tiny things in the distance.
Did you read also that to be like a regular journalist and to be a photojournalist uses completely different sides of your brain? So they're saying that the skill set is so sort of opposite that it's a train wreck.
It's visual. You know, you're not a writer.
Yeah.
Anyway. Well, that's what happens, though. I mean, we probably could have gotten calls a few years ago. Oh, my God, Polaroid's dying. This is the way it happens. It's disruptive. It's unhappy. And I feel for the people who are out of work. And it's not the last we're going to hear of this kind of thing happening. And frankly, I don't know. I remember the owner of the New York Times, Arthur Sulzberger, saying that he thought, and this was a few years ago, that in 10 years there would be no print edition. And they're probably right. So if you really like the newspaper, the physical newspaper, go out and buy a few.
Yeah.
Stop.
Either way, I like the pretty pictures.
Do you subscribe
in the paper.
To a newspaper, a physical newspaper? It's your fault. It's her fault.
But I read them online a ton.
Right.
And I click on ads.
There's not as much money. Not enough money to support that kind of huge staff. Well, remember Rupert Murdoch started an iPad newspaper called The Daily about 2 years ago. Hired 100 people for the newsroom, went out of business about 3 months ago.
Oh, my gosh.
There's not enough money. Not enough Crazy. Money. Remember The Daily? The Daily was 99 cents a week. Not enough people subscribed to it to pay for a 100-person newsroom. Now, Minus One has a very good point. What will people with birds do if they can't get newspapers to line the cages? And that's a national crisis that's coming soon. I don't mean to make light of it. I feel very badly for the people who lost their jobs. But if you are a good photographer, if you're a talented photojournalist, there are ways to make money. I don't think you need the Chicago Sun-Times. I feel more for the people who read the Chicago Sun-Times. We're going to have little teeny-weeny pictures of things in the distance because the reporters are using iPhones. That's crazy. That's crazy talk. Who should I talk to next?
Oh, we got to talk to Grant.
Thank you,
Heather.
We haven't
done any gaming stuff today, right?
No, so, let's do some gaming.
Let's do Grant.
Grant in Los Angeles. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Grant.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
I turned 10 2 days ago.
Oh, happy birthday, Grant. That's great. You're 10 years old. That's awesome. What can I do for you?
I'm wondering whether I should get like an Intel Pentium with a $120 graphics card, or get an AMD A series, A75, something like that, with the integrated graphics.
So that's a good question. That's a really good question. Now, if you're a gamer, what games do you play?
Question or comment?
Well, just kind of simple ones like free to play or kind of older video games, not the new ones.
Then you don't really have to worry. The older stuff isn't very demanding. But if you were playing Call of Duty or Crysis or, you know, Left 4 Dead, one of the really and they're all too adult for you anyway. I wouldn't let a 10-year-old play those. But if you do play those games, those are what we call first-person shooters.
Yeah, I know that. Action games.
And in order for those to work, you know, they have to draw the pictures in real time. You know, you don't know what you're going to look like or where you're going to be or what your opponent's going to be and where they're going to look, what they're going to look like until you're actually playing the game. So the processor, that's the AMD or the Intel CPU, does all the calculations and then it sends those to the graphics processing unit or GPU. And the GPU has to draw the picture, and it has to do it, you know, 30 times, a minimum of 30 times a second. And, if you really want a video game to look good, we're talking more like 90 to 100 times a second. So I would say that's a really legit question. But you phrased it strangely, because that's what I'm curious about. Because if you said, well, I'm going to save so much money on the AMD that I can buy a better video card— then that would be an interesting question. But you're saying I want to use AMD's built-in graphics.
I mean, couldn't I do like a combination of
you could
PCIe 2.
Yes.
Card of a gigabyte.
Yeah.
And then put that in Crossfire.
How old are you? You're kind of knowledgeable about this stuff. You're smart.
I've been researching for a while.
I think so. So Intel has beat AMD pretty soundly. The Intel processors are better, but in no case are the built-in graphics as good as a GPU independent GPU card. Okay. The built-in graphics on the new Intel Haswell chips reputedly is better. We haven't really seen them yet. They just came out today. But in general, onboard graphics, the stuff that comes with the chip, is not going to be as good as a graphics card. So if the choice is, should I get a graphics card or not, absolutely do. Okay? Even a $100 one's better than nothing. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Gosh, I love it when we get kids just turned 10, and he's going, well, I don't know about the AMD processor. I'm trying to think if I should get the... Wow. So, but he's not playing such demanding games that he really probably, it doesn't even matter at the kinds of games he's playing, aren't particularly demanding, but I'm just preparing for the future. You probably want to get a good video card because down the road you might start playing more challenging games. 8888 Ask Leo. Sean in Clovis, you're next. Leo Laporte, the tech guy. Hi, Sean.
Thanks for taking my call. Sure. I had a question in regards to cameras and video capturing. I do mostly workers' comp investigations, and I shoot with a Sony video camera. It's an HDR CX550. I also have a 750 at the house, and I shoot onto SD cards. I like the Sony because it's got a good X-more lens on it and good low light capabilities and such. But it shoots on I use 8 gigabyte cards because basically I get an hour's worth of film on each one of these cards. And then, I basically know, pretty much generally when I'm going to start running out of film so I can change them out. And I use different cards for each case that I do when I'm in the field and so on. But my question is in regards to the date timestamp overlay.
Oh, I get this call from PIs all the time.
Oh.
Yeah, and because these cards are going to be evidence or could be evidence.
Well, the cards themselves, I have permission from the carrier that I'm currently working for that as long as I burn exactly what's on the SD card to a master, it does qualify as physical evidence, as chain of evidence, and I'm good to go. But
Okay. Yes,
all the information is chain of evidence and right. It is admissible, and I have to testify to it.
Right.
So my question is in regards to the date timestamp overlay, and is there a way of, from the SD card, copying that film onto either Mac or PC-based computer and retaining the date timestamp overlay?
It has to be done in the camera. So if you're seeing it, but it's not being, in effect, I'm going to use the term burned into the video, then it's not there, and there's no way to put it there. I mean, you could put it there after the fact, but it's going to ruin the chain of evidence. So what you want is a camera, and some do this, not all, most don't, that will burn it onto the video as you're shooting it. You see what I'm saying?
The date timestamp is definitely visible on the video as you view it on the camera.
Yeah, but it's not being burned into it. No, I know it's there, but that's just the camera viewfinder. What you want is something that puts it on the video, right?
Yeah, you would think that it would be on the video.
No, you know why? You know why?
Why?
Because morons leave it on, and they get the video of graduation home, and they go, why is the date and time on here? So camera manufacturers, which used to have this as a switch, have removed it in most cases because people accidentally turn it on. So the fact that you're seeing it, you could see all sorts of stuff in the viewfinder. You could see what you're shooting at, how much time is left, right, how much. But none of that ends up on the final video. It's just what's in the
If I plug that, and this is how I've had to do it.
Oh, I see. If you play it back on the camera, you see it.
And if you
play it back. It
right.
burn in real time.
Right.
From the adapter cable with an RCA jack onto my desktop. The problem comes in that when I shoot 4 hours of film right. and I have to sit there in real time
right. I
and
got it.
Burn this.
You'd like to copy it off the memory chip just by dragging it.
That's for
yeah. So what's happening is when the camera's playing it back, there is time code on the video. It's invisible time code. So when the camera's playing it back, it is then burning it on from the physical time code.
That's
so,
correct.
Yeah. So, but it's not doing it if you just copy it. So what we want is to find a program that will import the copied files and read the time code and put the time code onto the video.
That would be
helpful. Yeah. So let me look. I think the Google search for this is to burn time code in while importing would be something I would use. And I'm not sure. Looks like Final Cut does support that, but that's kind of a high-end product for this. Premiere looks like it will do it. So some of the higher-end editors will do it. What do you use right now as your video editing?
Well, what I currently do is plug my camera from dongle thing
right.
with the RCA jack, video only, into a desktop standalone Sony burner and sit there and basically push record and let it run while I do my reports and whatnot. But when you're burning, 6 hours of video.
Yeah, you don't want to do it in real time. You want to copy the video over.
Yeah, it ties you to your desk. And I don't mind spending some money if Final Cut or Premiere will actually do it.
Right. Well, here's the, here's the search, which is burn time code while importing, and you'll find a number of programs that will do that. What I'd really like to see, so the other issue, of course, is you've got to make sure that it doesn't hamper chain of evidence. And
that's correct. I mean, it won't. I need it to not compromise the video or anything like that. And
well, because the time code's in the video, so all of the most cameras will do this. They're in the process of capturing video. They're also capturing information about when the video was shot in a non-visual place.
Right. It's there.
It's
yeah,
there.
Definitely. Yeah.
It's time code. Time code. So what you really want is something that will display the time code. Or something you can run. Now, I don't know if this would hurt chain of evidence or not. If you would run it through a converter that would take the video and put the time code on it, would that be okay?
As long as if everything's consistent, as long
right.
as it doesn't change the timestamp overlay, then
right.
we're good to go. Or even, I don't even know if that's the right terminology,
yep.
actually.
Here's a program, thanks to Padre SJ in our chat room. And he's a priest, so we know he's not lying. I presume the video is captured as MPEG, H.264. It's an AVCHD, right?
That is correct, sir.
Okay, so this program will do this. It's called Visual AVCHD Timestamp. It says it's a tool to add date and or timestamp to the captured AVCHD video files. So AVCHD has time code in it. Yeah.
And you said it was visual what?
Visual AVCHD timestamp. Windows 7 only. $20.
Oh, man, that's beautiful.
Yeah, thanks to Padre for figuring that one out. Thank you, Robert. So the idea is the time code is in there, and I think that I can't imagine this would hurt the chain of evidence. You'd have to testify, no, we use a program that takes the time code and displays it visually on the video.
Yeah, as long as it's actually... In other words, as long as it is not you're not doing anything.
You're not modifying it. I understand.
You're seeing on there, right?
Right.
But I have a second question. If you have a moment, I wanted to ask you if you know of any iPhone applications that will allow to obtain video off of an iPhone and have a date time stamp on it.
That's interesting. I'll tell you what. Keep listening. I'm gonna have to do some research on that one. That's a very good question.
I sure appreciate it.
You're
sir.
Welcome. Thank you. It's funny. I get this question probably once a month from PIs, and what happened with some of the cameras used to do this in recording. There'd be a switch, and it would obviously his does not. But in the recording, it would say, hey, just leave the, you've probably seen this in your old camcorder, leave the date and time on here. But I think what happened is it got complaints from people said, hey, I see the date and time on my video. I don't want that. How do I get rid of it? You can't. It's burned into it. So they just started taking it out. In fact, I even remember a PI calling saying, I updated my firmware and it used to do it and doesn't do it anymore. That's frustrating. It's a specialty, right? Because it's private investigators. Most people don't care if there's a date and time on the screen at all times, but a PI would. Subject was seen entering building with crutches at 4:42 in the afternoon on June 1st, leaving the building at 4:43 on June 1st without crutches and wearing tap shoes. You would want, you know, in court, you want to have that date and time right on there. So this looks like it does it. It does seem to be limited to Windows 7, not Windows 8. But I think if this exists. Now, can we do that with the iPhone? That's a good question. I'm not sure. The data's in there. I'm pretty sure the data's in there. iPhone records in a MOV format. This might even work on that. I don't know. If there's a program like this, this Visual AVC HD timestamp, and we'll put a link to it in the show notes, by the way, at techguylabs.com. If there's a program that could do this, I'm sure somebody must have written one for iPhone video, which is, you know, I think standard, pretty sure there's standard MPEG-4 videos. And maybe even put the GPS in there, too. Wouldn't that be nice? Date, time, and GPS. Then there'd be no question. Subject was seen skydiving shortly after he put the crutches aside. Will iMovie do that, Shadow XPR? That would be a good one. We'll keep looking. We'll see if we can find something. Wait a minute. Oh, here it is. Padre SJ to the rescue again. It's always good to have a priest in the handy here. Is it Stamper? Is that what you said? S-T-A-M-P-R. Stamper will do exactly that. Look at that. Stamper is an iPhone app. Pretty sweet. So I'm just talking. When did it end? Why do I do that? I don't know why I bought that down. I don't know what I'm doing. You could change the time on the camera, but see, what happens then is you have to test, you know, when you're sworn in, the prosecutor will say, and did any time change the time? And did you set the time to, yes, I did. I set it this time and that time and blah, blah, blah. Stamper. I didn't hear an end. John comes running in and says, you're not potted up. Padre SJ. Yeah, the 20th. I cannot, unfortunately. That one I can't skip. Oh, crap. Well, wait a minute. Now, let me think about it. I think that... Oh. Yeah, let's talk after the show. I have to think about that. Padre used to be a PI for the Catholic Church, he says. No. Maybe. Do you have a lot of workers' comp claims, Padre? Hello, Traverse City, Michigan. Leo Laporte, the tech guy, 8888 Ask Leo. That's the number. We talk tech each weekend at this time on this station. Please, 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 I beg of you, tune in each and every week. You don't want to miss a minute. Right now, joining us via the magic of Skype, Mr. Dick DiBartolo, Mad Magazine's maddest writer and our own Giz Whiz, gadget fanatic, where he is in New York City, where it is a balmy 100 degrees right now.
Well, right now it's like 92.
Oh, so, it's cooling. It's cooling.
Yeah, it's cooling down, yeah. Holy so you do cow. This every weekend?
I'm sorry, Dick. I thought you knew.
Oh, no wonder. Yeah. No wonder Dennis says every Saturday. I have to keep you busy. Leo says keep you busy for 3 hours.
Every Saturday.
That's okay, because I know about it now.
So Mr. Dickey D joins us each week to talk about some kind of crazy cool gadget that he's found. You know, we do a show called The Gizwiz on Tuesdays on the Twit Podcast Network, twit.tv/gizwiz. And last Tuesday, we did this Death Star, Lego Death Star. It was awesome. Oh,
that was amazing. That was
have you seen the time-lapse of that?
I did. It is. No. Oh, that's time-lapse?
No, he didn't build it in 3 minutes. It's 3,800 pieces. It's probably on one of our pages somewhere. But it was really...
That's probably as part of the... I think we rolled it into the Gizwiz.
Is it in the Gizwiz? All right. That'd be the best way to see it then.
Yeah.
Google Plus. It's on Google Plus?
Jason posted it.
Okay. So Jason Howell posted it on his Google Plus page. That'd be another way to find it. It's on Inside Twit. Inside.twit.tv.
It's everywhere.
It's everywhere. Inside.twit.tv is our blog. I don't see it here. Maybe it's a link to it
Google
somewhere.
Plus.
Can we just put this on Inside Twit so people can see it? Because it's cool. Jeff Needles, he was an intern. I guess we've hired him now for huge amounts of money because he's so good at building Lego. And I can't tell you,
every corporation,
every
needs
business,
a master Lego builder.
So good to have. Dick, what do you have for us?
That I thought the radio audience would love because we all love gadgets. Everything needs to be charged. So this is one of the most feature-laden wall charges I have come across. It's from Best Tech, spelled B-E-S-T-E-K. You can charge 5 devices at one time. There are 4 USB devices, inputs, 2 2.1 amps, 2 1 amp, at the top a 30-pin docking station. I've been using that for my iPod Touch. Then on either side, 3 AC outlets for a total of 6. Now you'll be giving up 2 outlets when you plug this in, although you could, I guess you could plug it into a power strip and just use up 1 outlet. Built-in night light, the logo lights up. That would be a very low-key night light. Then there's a power switch for high and low night light. The best thing is I paid $19 and change on Amazon, and it was Amazon Prime, so I got it in 2 days.
Now, Dick has put a video up of this on his website, or his YouTube channel, youtube.com/gizwiz. The Best Tech Wall Charging Station.
Charging station.
Yeah.
A very good buy in my mind. I know you have the copyrighted buy or don't buy. So
it's not copyrighted. You're allowed to use that.
Oh,
is
okay.
It a buy?
It's a buy.
You can find out more. In fact, I found it on his website, gizwiz.biz. That's where you can also play the What the Heck Is It contest, a chance to win an autographed copy of Mad Magazine. I found the video. It's on our Inside Twit YouTube. YouTube.com/InsideTwit. This is the video of the Lego Death Star. 3,800 pieces. It took him over 12 hours to build. And John made a time lapse of it, which is kind of amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing to watch Jeff, who, you know.
And if you do watch it, watch the little people who will board the Death
they
Star.
Dance.
They dance.
They dance.
Like they're impatient. Come on, finish it. I want to get aboard. Come on. I got all my luggage here.
You know, it's not the biggest Lego ever. Did you go out and see when they put out the Imperial Fighter? It was a life-sized.
Yes. Oh, the one down in Times Square.
Yeah, down in Times Square, yeah.
I did not go down there.
Wow. That was amazing. That thing was a full-sized replica of an Imperial Fighter. By the way, this Lego Death Star, there is a small thermal exhaust port, if you can find it. It's not fully operational any day now, though. We're working on it.
Yes, and did you mention the price?
Of the Death Star?
My gadget was under $20.
Yours was under $20 with the free Amazon shipping if you're Amazon Prime.
Exactly.
The
and
Death
this
Star?
One was, what, a penny under $400?
Yeah.
Something like
$399.99.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, less than $400.
Yeah. And it doesn't even charge anything.
It doesn't go anywhere. And if you touch it, Jeff will hit you.
Yeah.
So I didn't know about that part. They should put that on the box. If you touch this, Jeff will actually physically assault you.
No!
Thank you, Dickie D. We will catch you on the Giz Fizz right after the radio show and the Giz Whiz every Tuesday, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern time on twit.tv. Take care, Dick.
I'll be there.
I'll see you there. I think we could get one more call in here. Let's see before we wrap this up. Herbert in Oregon. Hi, Herbert. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
How you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
Well, I'm just finding a frog here. this is a statement for you. I was a customer of Sprint and currently a customer of T-Mobile. Sprint does truly have unlimited data plans, but if you roam too much within a billing period consistently, they will ask you to leave their network and then go to somewhere else.
Roaming costs them money. Remember, they have to pay the carrier that you've roamed to. And see, that's an issue if Sprint doesn't have good coverage where you are in Oregon, because you will roam a lot. Does T-Mobile have better coverage where you are?
Yes. And T-Mobile truly does have unlimited, but they...
Well, I bet you if you started roaming a lot, they might give you the same hard time. It comes down to getting a carrier that has good coverage where you are.
Right. Well, I am a truck driver, so I do roam quite a bit.
Oh, you roam a lot. Yeah.
So T-Mobile, as long as you're on their network, does have unlimited. Right. If you have a lot of roaming, they actually will give you a limited amount of roaming, then they cut it off, period.
Right.
And then
at least you don't lose your account.
No, you don't lose the account, which is one of the stressing things that I had.
Yeah, that's very annoying. You know, all the cell carriers have their quirks. I have to say though, because T-Mobile is fourth out of four, they do seem to work a little harder. I have my Galaxy S4 is on T-Mobile, and I have the $70 everything unlimited plan. And I love it, but I get good T-Mobile coverage here. There's another advantage to T-Mobile since nobody else uses them. I get most of the bandwidth that's on that cell site to myself. You know, it's always good to have a carrier that's not widely used as long as their coverage is good where you are. Sprint, while in some areas is very good, it's not good here in Petaluma, and I sounds like where you're driving doesn't have great coverage, and at that point, you know, it's not a good choice for you, so... I'm glad you're happy with T-Mobile. I am too. I'm very happy with it.
Well, thank you. I just want to let you know that.
Yeah, appreciate it. Yeah, great to hear from you. Thanks for calling. Keep listening. Our website is techguylabs.com. Great place to go if you want to find out more about any of the things I talked about. After the show, we put audio and video up. We break it down into individual questions so you can actually watch me answer. You know, watch the question, watch me answer it, and this is the most important part, as far as I'm concerned. You can add your comments, your thoughts. So if you're listening to the radio and you're yelling at me right now, the best thing to do in the world, just go to the website, find that question, and add it, because the website's free. It's always going to be open. We're never going to charge for it. And when you go there, you know, and add something, you're adding to the value of that site. We've got a very good search on it, so people can find, you know, they want to know about it. Well, how's, you know, Sprint versus T-Mobile? They'll search for Sprint T-Mobile. They'll find this question, this answer, and... I hope your comments on all of these. Maybe we can help find a stamper, I guess, was the iPhone stamping program for public or private eyes. Not public eyes. That's something else. Heather, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you all for listening. Thanks to Nathan S. I'll get his name right one of these days. Nathan S. is for our musical director. And thanks to you all for being here. TechGuyLabs.com. The conversation continues all throughout the week on our podcast network, twit.tv, named one of the 50 best websites by Time Magazine. I don't know how that happened. Must have a fan somewhere. Time Magazine. Anyway, so stop by there if you want more geeky stuff. Heather, you're going to come back tomorrow and do this again?
Can we please?
Please.
I can't wait.
I feel bad. I see Jason and Jonathan, you know, still on the line. We'll get them next time.
Yeah, call back tomorrow.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody, for being here. We'll talk again next week. Leo Laporte, or next time, actually. Leo Laporte, the Tech Guy. Have a great geek week. Well, that's it for the Tech Guy show for today. I'm Leo Laporte. Thank you so much for joining us. Don't forget, the Tech Guy is just the tip of the iceberg. We do nearly 30 shows now on the Twit Netcast Network, and you'll find them all at twit.tv. We talk about Windows and Windows Weekly, Macintosh and MacBreak Weekly, iPad and iPad Today. You get your daily dose of tech news from Tech News Today and our weekly roundtable show, This Week in Tech. It's all at twit.tv. And I'll be back next time with another great Tech Guy podcast. Thanks for joining me. See you next time.